Oh, the ball's wide outside the off stump, and Woakes is chasing after it, looking to swat it away. And there's the declaration. We were anticipating it, and there it comes. England declare at 490 for eight. That's a statement of confidence for this England side after the position they were in mid-afternoon.
Hello, 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 and welcome to a far more Yorkshire-y scene. It's gloomy, it's grey, it's damp, it's been drizzly and rainy overnight. Not so rainy, necessarily, though there are patches of rain. Indeed, the players out in front of me are playing football, but this is going to be the fifth and final day of the second Investec Test match between England and the West Indies, with a match wonderfully poised, fascinatingly set up. I have to bring you some slightly disappointing news, though, which is that play has been delayed to 11:15 because of that rain. It's a slight curiosity, because, as I say, the players are playing football out here, so it's not the outfield problem. I don't think the players are particularly fussed, and they'll be happy to get going, but they are not. Anyway, since weather could prove to be extremely important today, let's head straight over to Simon King for a prognosis, a forecast, if you will, for the day's play.
Yeah, I'm surprised, actually, because I'm just looking at the rainfall radar and we have got a few spots of rain towards the south of Leeds, but actually it's looking dry, and if anything, I guess it's just a very, very light drizzle that you might see. But the good news is that it's all clearing to the south, so while it might stay quite cloudy well into this afternoon, there will eventually be some brighter skies developing over Headingley. A bit of sunshine perhaps from 2-3 o'clock this afternoon. Now, yesterday, temperatures got to about 22, 23 Celsius. Today, you'll notice that difference. The cooler, fresher air is with you. So maximum temperatures only about 17 degrees today. But as I said, I'm surprised by the delay this morning, because the drizzle rain is clearing south and eastward. It's not going to affect the majority of play. So a dry day expected, really.
Well, Simon, thanks so much for that. That's a very hopeful prognosis. I'm going to put that, first of all, to Fazir. 17 degrees today. It's clearing up. It's going to be sunnier in the afternoon. That 15-minute delay, that's 15 minutes in gloomy conditions the West Indies wouldn't have wanted to bat in. This is a good delayed start for your boys, isn't it?
Well, I'm actually looking at it the other way. I'm thinking that we're going to miss out on 15 minutes for a few more runs and could actually find ourselves having to accelerate a bit more towards the end of the day to win this one.
Well, I think you could get that 15 minutes back, I hope. I mean, we'll check and we'll find out. But now let's start with the West Indies, because yesterday it was a tough day. They had England where they wanted them, effectively 40-odd for four at one point, 168 for seven at another point. And then, well, it was taken away from you in that just pre- and post-tea session, wasn't it?
Taken away, yes. Take nothing away from Moeen Ali and the rest of the batting. Woakes with his contribution. But I thought the West Indies contributed in allowing England to take it away, because it was bewildering, even when Roston Chase took those three wickets. 160-odd for seven at that point. And there was just a definite lack of intensity in the West Indies' effort, as if at that point they had already come to their own conclusion that they couldn't win the Test match anymore. It was utterly bewildering. So, yeah, I mean, England played great, fantastic partnership, tremendous enjoyment towards the end, but you just didn't get the sense that the West Indies believed they could win the match.
Well, Fazir, we're going to chew the card over what was an extraordinary day, and we're going to look forward to what still promises to be an absolutely fascinating day with all four results possible. But first, let's look back on yesterday with our very own pint-sized TMS. Cuts into the hands, taken. He juggled it, but Root has gone. Driven and call no drops. Kieran Powell at first slip.
And Stokes produces a glorious extra cover drive for four. Gave for bowling. And gets an inside edge, and he gets his 50. An excellent effort from him, really determined. He had to battle out there for an awfully long time.
Stokes launches this high, down to long off. Is he going to be caught, or is he hit it over his head for six? He's caught. Caught on the boundary, long off, the first ball after drinks. Yeah! They've always bowled him. Cleaned him up.
The West Indies right back in
there. They are. Match. What a game.
Oh, he's bowled him!
who's trying to play a reverse sweep. What kind of a shot was that at this stage? Oh, my word.
Bishoo bowls to Moeen. It's a no ball. He's caught behind.
Unforgivable. A spin bowler bowled a no-e.
Here comes Gabriel and he bowls to Moeen. That's a lovely stroke. Oh, that's made by Dave. The Moeen cover drive.
And Moeen brings up his 50 with another beautiful shot through the offside. Half century in 54 balls. He is so easy on the eye.
Moeen Ali on 84 weeks and he's swinging this one out to long on. Is the catch going to be taken? It is. But an excellent innings, an attacking innings, a typical innings from Moeen Ali comes to an end. From the football stand, it goes short and he's pulling this one away. Shannon Gabriel is not even bothering to chase after him, just ambling.
The West Indies already look a beaten team.
And there's the declaration, leading by 321. That's a statement of confidence.
Here's Moeen Ali, bowls.
Close.
I'm
just outside the line.
I'm going to say it's outside the line, missing off the stump.
They have survived those six overs. What a wonderful fifth day of a five-day test match we have at Crossbank.
Well, you can watch those highlights on the website or via the BBC Sport app. Now, I'm joined by a whole galaxy of stars, but I'm going to start with Michael Vaughan. And what I'm listening back to those highlights, what I want to start with you is, it's a very hairy moment for England when they lost a few wickets. Jonny Bairstow played a shot of, I don't think he'll be too pleased about. And England then looked like they were getting a bit aggressive, a bit early, didn't they? That, you know, that phase from the moment Stokes got out after drinks, the moment when Jonny Bairstow was out. It's quite frenetic cricket from England then. It could have gone wrong.
Yeah, but I think that's the moment that the class in the sides almost was created. The West Indies didn't believe. That was the time where Jason Holder could have got his team together and said, come on, let's just win this next half an hour. Moeen Ali strolled to the wicket, started timing the ball. They didn't turn to Shannon Gabriel quick enough. I think the one area that you can attack Moeen Ali is with some short, sharp balls. Someone like Gabriel's aggressive. They didn't turn to him quick enough. They kept the spinner on. By the time that the team came on, Kemar Roach, he kind of planted a few through the offside and he was away. So I thought that was the moment where the West Indies didn't really believe that they could win this test match. England are a powerful batting line at that bat all the way down. And, you know, I think with the likes of Bairstow, he'll be disappointed with his shot, you know, but when you've got the likes of Moeen Ali and particularly Woakes, because Woakes plays the old attritional way. If I'm an opening batsman of the opposing team and I see someone like Woakes coming in at nine, I hate that. You know, I want players at 9, 10, 11 to play all the shots, give a few chances, and you know, you want to be getting your pads on as quick as possible. But Woakes is a frustration for the opposing side because he will just occupy the crease, he will hit the ball on the floor, he won't try too much, he'll just kind of know his game plan. I think for Moeen Ali at 8, he's the perfect foil, and I love Moeen at 8. You know, I know there's many that would have him higher up the order, but I just think the free spirit nature of the way that he plays the game, the way that he times ball, and once he gets in that boundary hitting mode, again, I always look at it as a captain, and how do you set fields to him? Because he's got all the gift to be able to work it on either side of the pitch. He's got that glance over third man. He got the pull shout on a couple of occasions, and you think, well, very difficult, but just the mentality of the West Indies side. I just don't think they believe that they could win the test match.
Well, you mentioned Moeen Ali, and unsurprisingly, we spoke to him last night at the close of play, and I started by asking how he rated his innings yesterday.
It was good. It was nice. I mean, it was a nice time to go out and bat. Actually, they were pretty tired, and we just sort of counteracted that a little bit, and I just felt take them off almost, like not let them settle with the ball, especially the seamers. And obviously, there was a bit of spin there, but it was just nice. I feel like I play spin all right sometimes, so it was good today.
When he came out to batting, a bit of a hairy position, and then lost Jonny Bairstow soon after. You had to really rebuild with Chris Woakes. But the thinking straight after tea was what?
Just to keep batting, and I felt good before the tea break, and I felt like the way I'm just going to keep playing. I'm just going to, when the bad ball comes, and I felt like I got quite a few today, and I just tried to put them away and almost building five-run partnerships with Chris Woakes. We just went up in fives and not really thought about anything else.
At tea, was there any thought of a target? Because obviously we've had a declaration today, which came as quite a surprise to us, a very bold one, we thought. Was that talked about at tea?
No, it wasn't at all. We were just thinking, just do the same thing and try and get the bowlers tired and then pounce on anything loose, but there was no talk whatsoever. I think the momentum that we took into our batting after tea was crucial, and to almost make them fetch the ball a little bit, you know, hit those gaps. And so I've always looked for the boundary option and not get stuck, almost not go too defensive and try and take it to them a little bit.
You're out there for long enough to assess the pitch, and the spinners came into it a lot.
you're going to be bowling tomorrow. What did you learn from that pitch in the time you were batting?
I felt not every ball spun. There is obviously spin in the wicket, especially from a bit wider for the footballs, but from the straight ball, I felt the odd ball did spin and it wasn't as easy. And if you put the batter, if you put the ball under pressure a little bit, then make him lose his length a little bit, not getting settled. But there was, I did feel, especially early on in my innings, I felt it was quite dangerous against the spinners.
Tomorrow, obviously, you've got 10 wickets to take. It's a very clear equation, 317 to get. We saw you come on for the last over of the day. Is that a sign of things to come? Are you expecting to have a heavy workload tomorrow?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, last day pitch, as a sole spinner, I think you always look like you're going to bowl. Hopefully be overcast for the seamers as well. And I feel when the sun's out, it's quite nice to bat. And then when it's overcast, it's not as easy. The wicket feels like it's a bit softer and stuff. And I think that helps the spinners as well. So hopefully I can get a good bowl tomorrow.
Do you relish that prospect that all eyes are going to be on you as you try to spin out the West Indies tomorrow?
I think so. I mean, I feel like I've been bowling quite well lately. I mean, first things, I didn't get any wickets, but hopefully secondly, the last 2 days of this test match is my days after dropping that catch first thing.
So indeed, spin will be important, you would imagine. Speaking to Moeen Ali then, he had plenty of time to assess the pitch and see it while he was out there batting yesterday during that fabulous 84. I have no one better to talk about off spin and the art of off spin here at Headingley than the man who's taken 10 wickets himself here on a pitch that, what do people say, spin's no use. But Moeen Ali's going to be crucial today, isn't he, Graham?
Oh, absolutely. It's not the Headingley wicket of old. You know, back in the 80s, 90s, the single test selection wickets like Neil Mallard and people like that, it wasn't a spinner's haven at all. But just recently, the last 10 years or so, since the drainage, actually, since they flattened the ground, the wicket's changed a lot. It's a lot better for batting. Now, you can ask Michael Vaughan that. This wicket compared to Headingley 15 years ago is ridiculous for batting. And it does turn. It's turned the whole game. The spinners have actually bowled poorly the entire game. They've just not put the ball in the right areas consistently enough to take wickets. But if Moeen Ali can do that today, get in the right area, he's going to cause all sorts of problems.
Now, I want to ask you about that. What specifically is the right area and what's the right angle of attack for this pitch?
Well, it's quite simple. You've got to get it full. You've got to get people on the front foot. And it's just a good length, 6-7 inches outside off stump to the right-handers. And then to the left is just make a play. Every ball's got to hit off stump, whether it's spinning or whether it's going on. So it's all there for Mo. I mean, he'll not get a better wicket to bowl last day on. And that one over he bowled last night fills me with confidence for him because, I mean, six balls, could have had three wickets in those six balls. So I'm expecting good things from Mo tonight.
I was going to say exactly that. Those six balls he bowled were all far more threatening than the previous 30 balls, which is something that's a bit strange, isn't it? Do you think that while the cloud cover is out, though, England are going to kick off, because that ball's only six overs old.
Well,
they'll kick
will.
Off with Broad and Anderson,
yeah,
you'd imagine. And
undoubtedly, they'll go with seamers, cause especially if it swings. I mean, it didn't swing a jot last night. End of the day, tired crowd. None of that affects the swing, but something in the air just didn't really work for swing bowling last night. So, yeah, Jimmy will definitely start with Stuart. And I wouldn't be surprised if... what they need to do, those guys, they can't just be seen as taking the shine off the ball. They need to chip in. Jimmy Adam Anderson has been wonderful his whole career at doing it. Even the second innings, in India and in Sri Lanka, he'll always pick up two or three wickets. Get through the top order, get the spinner onto the middle and lower order. That's when spinners get 5-6 for, when they're bowling at the tail on day five. It is a bit of a secret. Everyone thinks, oh, he must have bowled well. You don't get Brian Lara out five times. You get 9-10 Jack out. It's great.
Well, we're going to talk more about Jimmy Anderson later because he's only 3 wickets away from 500. So we will explore that later on before the start of play. But there's further news on demerit point gate because there's more of them. They're falling from the sky like confetti. This has come. I'm reading out something. It says Jason Holder. It's from the ICC website. Jason Holder has been reprimanded for breaching the ICC Code of Conduct. Windies captain Jason Holder has received an official reprimand for breaching level one of the ICC Code of Conduct during the fourth day's play at Headingley Test against England on Monday. Holder was found to have breached Article 2.1.4 of the ICC Code of Conduct for players and player support personnel, which relates to, and I quote, using language or a gesture that is obscene, offensive or insulting during an international match. In addition to the reprimand for his breach of Article 2.1.4, one demerit point has been added to Holder's disciplinary record. Now, this is all starting to get a bit ludicrous, isn't it? That this was a vocalised frustration, Fazir, as we understand it. And you could hardly blame the man for being slightly frustrated by what was going on yesterday. And he is a captain of the side. Where do you stand on this?
Well, that's just it. You know, where do you draw the line? And we've been having this discussion over and over, especially since the Ben Stokes one, and everyone's been talking about it. Where do you draw the line between a normal expression of disappointment or anguish or whatever it is, and what is clearly an audible and inappropriate obscenity? There might be a fine line, but the point is, if you're involved in competitive sport, this is what it's all about. So it's either you switch off the microphones altogether, and those who will read lips will find they'll work it out. But it's all getting a bit muddled, and as I said, it's just jobs for lawyers, really. And I'm not saying that Holder is should be excused in the same way that I'm not saying that Ben Stokes should be excused. But it is something that is part of competitive sport. You're not going to expect grown men or women in a competitive environment where there's a level of intensity not to say the occasional obscenity. But it's in a sporting context.
No, it's ridiculous. I don't understand. It's absolutely pathetic. Jason Holder, his team are trying to win a test match, been hammered at Edgbaston. A snick goes through to Kieran Powell at first slip. Should have been taken. The keeper goes for it, then he doesn't go for it. Gives the first slip no chance, really, with the way that he went. And then, you know, the natural reaction. If I'm out there, I'm sorry, if I'm playing cricket, and my team are trying to win a test match, just been criticised for a few days, and all of a sudden a simple chance goes down at a key moment. I'm saying a lot worse than what Jason Holder said. I'd be going for the juggler. I wouldn't ever play in this. My point is also this. If a batsman gets hit and you get one in the ribs and you swear because of frustration that you've been hit in the ribs and it's painful, my natural reaction was always to, unfortunately, if it's the wrong, to swear when I got hit. If that gets picked, is that a demerit point as well? When you walk off, you see many players walk off with a helmet on, you know, probably speaking to themselves. Is that demerit points? Touch of grey air. I think it's ridiculous.
Well, James, you would think that overrates would be more of a concern to the ICC than the occasional vocalised bit of frustration.
Yeah, exactly. You'd imagine they've got other things to be concentrating on. Yes, players should, ideally in a perfect world, they wouldn't swear, but we don't live in a perfect world, and there's plenty more things going on that you'd imagine they can concentrate. Like Michael said, it's the frustration of sport, isn't it? You let your emotions overflow sometimes, and yes, again, people are saying, well, they don't have to swear, but they do. It's just the way it is. It's the world we live in. Ideally, they wouldn't, but they're showing their frustration and they're almost the passion of when things don't go right. That's natural expletive to come out. So it's a shame, and it's for me, it's a little bit pathetic, and it's gone a fraction too far now to keep giving people demerit points. And ultimately, in the end, it's just going to stop the best players playing the odd game, like we saw in the South Africa series. Rabada not playing, one of the world's best bowlers. People rocking up to the grounds want to see the best players playing. Ben Stokes has been potentially might get banned for an Ashes game. You want to see the best players playing, and if people keep handing out demerit points, that's going to stop, unfortunately, some of the best players taking part in the biggest games.
Well, there's a reason for his frustration, and that was not just Moeen Ali, it was also Chris Woakes, who batted fantastically when he came in a very difficult situation with England effectively just 168 ahead with 7 wickets down. And I spoke to him at close of play and I asked him how he handled that pressure.
Going at that point, we were just trying to creep up to a score that we thought we could potentially bowl at. But, you know, just tried to build a partnership with Moeen. Obviously, he was going pretty well. And when he's playing strokes like that and going as quick as he was, it was nice to watch at the other end, to be honest. I was just trying to support him, and we built a decent partnership. We tried to go slowly and go up in fives, not try and look too far ahead. And that worked for us. You know, we managed to get on top of a few of the West Indies bowlers and, you know, and build a decent partnership. And, you know, it was really nice to watch Moeen at the other end the way he was batting.
Well, I don't know if you know, but you've equaled England's record 8-wicket partnership at Headingley, which is the iconic one between Botham and Dilley back in 1981. But when you come out batting at number 9, people often say, you know, it's much harder. You bat like a number 9 if you are a number 9. You didn't look like you're batting like a number 9 today.
Yeah, no, I don't try and bat like a number 9. I try and bat like a batsman. I, you know, work hard on my batting, you know, speak with Mark Ramprakash quite a bit, and having the mindset of a batsman. You know, sometimes when you come in as a tail ender, you know, you're in that mindset where you're just there to get a few runs. But actually, I try and occupy the crease and build a partnership with the guy at the other end. And, you know, luckily enough, I was managed to do that with Moeen today.
At what point did the declaration come out to you, the notion of being a declaration? Because presumably there wasn't one while you were batting with Moeen, and then Stuart Broad came out, hit his first ball for four. Did he come out with an instruction that you were looking for X number of runs?
No, he didn't. I mean, Stu comes out and plays his shots usually anyway, so the scoring rate was always going to increase. I think we put on a bit of partnership. I got to 50, and then yeah, I think there was a signal from the dressing room, which was to, you know, either say get on with it or we're calling you in, sort of thing. So we had to dip that last over, and then yeah, the over was called, and then they called us in. So yeah, that was it. Effectively had an over to.
So it was literally one over that before that you had no idea, you weren't expecting to have to bowl. You thought I could just keep on batting, maybe get a maiden first class 100, and then an over later it's come in, mate, get your bowling boots on.
Well, I mean, I still obviously had to get another 39 runs or something before I got 100, but yeah, I think, you know, it was literally that from the dressing room. We didn't get too much of a, you know, a heads up, but sometimes it's good like that because you can just put, you know, the way we were playing, we were picking up runs anyway. It wasn't like we'd stagnated in any way. You know, so to pick up those crucial runs, I suppose, in that last over was nice. And then we got the call.
It's a bold declaration. Do you think it's Joe Root showing confidence in you as a team and as a bowling unit?
Yeah, I think it is. You know, it's obviously a positive one. We want to go out there and win the Test match. You want to make sure you've got enough runs, but you also want to make sure you've got enough time, isn't it? It's a difficult one to balance. So, you know, the fact that the skipper and the management up there have called us in, they obviously, you know, back us to go out there tomorrow, and, you know, we've got enough runs. You know, we're going to have to bowl well. There's no doubt about that. I mean, it's still a decent pitch. It's spinning a little bit. Hopefully it does deteriorate on day five, and that brings us into the game. But, you know, some hard work tomorrow ahead.
Well, we'll move on to that declaration in a moment, but Graham Swan wants to say something on the demerit gate situation.
Yeah, very simple solution. Charity swear jar. If you swear out loud and get caught, you say sorry, pay £1,000 and it all goes to charity. Everyone who's title stops swearing.
Well, it's a genius idea. It's a genius idea. If you like that, tweet us at BBC, TMS and whatnot. Now, I want to talk about that declaration. I've got a former England captain here, Michael Vaughan, who knows Joe Root very well. What do you make of that declaration?
Well, I thought it was proactive, if you want to call it that. I mean, he's going for the victory. You know, I think his batsman had set him up for that declaration, where that Moeen Ali came and played, and Chris Woakes hung in there, Stuart Broad flung the bat. It was just a moment where I saw Woakes suddenly play a pull shot and then whack one through extra cover. You thought, yeah, it's going to be coming. You know, you've got to ask the opposition what they'd least like to do, and I thought, you know, the likes of Brathwaite and Powell, the last thing that they wanted after a tough day in the field was to go and face six overs of Anderson, a bit of Broad, and then Moeen Ali in the last over. So, yeah, I thought it was a very, very smart piece of captaincy.
James, did England slightly waste it, though? They had that six overs. They didn't make the best use of the ball in that time, did they? The idea would have been to try and pick up a wicket or two last night.
Yeah, it wasn't perfect. They didn't get that wicket that they were desperately striving for, but they asked enough questions, not as many as they wanted, but Moeen Ali's last over was exceptional. Three big appeals, possibly could have reviewed a couple. He bowled nicely, and that kind of sets the tone for today. The pitch is spinning. West Indies bowled far too wide. Their spinners bowled far too wide. I want Moeen Ali, like Graham Swan said earlier, to attack the stumps, bowl a fraction straighter, and it's spinning, and the pitch is right in his favour, and I expect him to play a big part for England today.
Now, I want to bring Fazir in on this, and I want you to be honest with me. When the declaration took place, do you think the West Indies were happy at that, or did they wanted to stay out in the field for a little bit longer?
Quite frankly, I don't think they cared, because their mentality suggested that they really wanted to have no part of this match anymore. Hopefully, the attitude would have changed overnight, and they will have to realise that even if a victory looks way out of the picture, that they've got a chance of saving the match. I mean, we all talk about the famous situation in Dominica with Shannon Gabriel and that penultimate delivery of the last over, but they won in Sharjah. They saved a Test match against England, batting a day and a half in Antigua a couple of years ago. So it's not as if it's completely unprecedented. It is going to be extremely difficult. I don't think there's any issue about that. The odds heavily favour England winning this Test match on this last day, but it's not out of the realms of possibility for the West Indies to bat properly, focused, and show that what happened yesterday, where they just seemed to want no part of the action, that they can turn it around and play properly and try their best to save this match.
Well, last night after the close of play, I spoke to Roddy Estwick, the West Indian bowling coach, about pretty much exactly that, and I asked why they didn't seize the initiative yesterday.
Yeah, we didn't play the big moments well at all today. When the captain Joe Root got up, they were 40 odd for four, and we then dropped to a catch soon after. So the big moments we didn't play well at all. But it's a very young team and we're still learning. They've got to learn that when you have the initiative and the momentum, you've got to run with it for as long as possible.
And did you sense, so that there just wasn't enough left in the tank from your fast bowlers after tea? I mean, that seemed to be a moment where just one more wicket and England could have subsided, set you 200 or fewer.
Well, when you go in with three seamers, it's also very, very difficult, you know. And on a very good pitch, we've got to give the groundsman here at Headingley credit. It was a good pitch. It's been a good pitch all the way through, you know. And it was difficult after tea. You could see that the boys really wanted to put in a big effort, but they didn't have a lot of energy left.
And it seemed that Roston Chase was being used more as a spearhead spinner than Devendra Bishoo. Is that a reasonable assumption for us to make up in the commentary box?
Well, Bishoo is the number one spinner. There's no doubt about that at all. But maybe the captain felt with two left-handers in. And Roston bowled very, very well today. And with two left-handers, he felt that the off-spinner. And Roston's been a good spinner for us over the last year or so. So, you know, it's all about a judgment call. And if the captain has a feeling and he wants to run with it, we've got to support him on it.
Your bowlers don't have any more work to do now in this game. The first match was at Edgbaston was a bit of a horror show for you. Conceded a lot of runs there. It's been a massive turnaround. It's got to be said, whatever the situation is tonight. Who have you been most impressed with in your lineup in this test?
Well, I've been impressed with the whole team. I think the attitude has been spot on. We've had some meetings. We've had some honesty in our meetings. And players have knuckled down and they're prepared to work. And, you know, coming to England, you've got to make technical changes, and we've had to do that. So it's all learning, and we're hoping that once they leave England, we're better for it, and people will start hearing about West Indies cricket again.
I mean, isn't it part of a confidence issue that you find yourself in this situation? Because there haven't been many situations lately when the West Indies have won high-profile matches, and there was an opportunity to do that today. You didn't quite drive home the advantage. Is that a function of not having done it recently or recently enough with these players?
Well, you seem to be saying that the match is over, and the match is far from over. For us, we've got 317 runs to make tomorrow, and we've still got to believe that we can win the game. You know, I can go back as far as 1984 when you declared and gave us 300 and odd to win, and we got it with two wickets down. So don't write us off yet. We're not out of it. We'll be back and we'll be fighting. We'll regroup tonight. We'll have our discussions and we'll come back fighting.
Well, that was really fighting talk from Roddy Eswick at the end there. And I think, actually, in 1984, they got it with one wicket down. Wasn't that one wicket a run out? So Roddy Eswick still believes, Fuzzier. I want to ask you, when was the last time the West Indies won a high-profile game? And what were the circumstances around that happening?
It was very different circumstances in Sharjah late October of last year. They had already lost the first two test matches, and in the end, it turned out to be a pretty good victory. They were 51 for 5, chasing 150 out, and got there in the end with Kraigg Brathwaite unbeaten in both innings. And he's going to be a key man again for the West Indies, you suspect, with that 100 in the first innings. But everyone's got to deliver. Then the series had been lost. This series is still very much alive. They beat Pakistan again in Barbados when Pakistan was set a small total, and they had that sense of belief. So it's really a case of whether these players, when they come out this morning, do they really believe they have a chance of first saving this test match, and if things work out their way, putting England under a bit of pressure later on. It seems completely out of the realms of possibility based on what we saw in the latter stages of yesterday. But again, fighting words from Roddy Eswick. They've got to show that those fighting words mean something when they come out this morning.
If you're just joining us, by the way, I'm wondering why we're still talking and you can't hear Jerusalem. Fear not, we're going to get cricket before very long. Scheduled start of play is 11:15 after some overnight drizzle. The noises you can hear, I know Graham Swan shaking his head, it does seem extraordinary, but the rope is going round on tractors. Everything's going to be fine before very long, and it's an irksome delay. And one that, yet I'd say, might help the West Indies, because the sky is lifting, the sun's starting to appear behind that bank of gloomy grey cloud. Now, I've got a batsman with me, James Taylor. How are West Indies going to approach this? Are they looking at the total, or are they looking at batting out the day and seeing where they get to?
Yeah, well, they've got to set the platform first. That first hour is crucial. These conditions are perfect bowling conditions for the England trio, Broad, Anderson and Woakes. It's perfect. Cloudy, overhead conditions, and that's at Headingley, that's when the ball does the most. It's a decent surface, though. For a fifth-day wicket, yes, it's spinning, but for the seamers, it's offering a little bit. So as a batsman, there's an opportunity for you to get your head down, score, but back time. And I think they need to set the platform, get to lunch. They need to get to lunch. Ideally, they wouldn't be any more than two down maximum, and then they've got a real chance. Once they set that platform, they can go from there. And we'll see. I mean, every result is possible today. I mean, it's exciting for the neutral, and it's exciting for everybody involved. And if West Indies apply themselves like they did in the first innings, they've got a real chance.
Well, there are no demons in this pitch. It's and there's previous at Headingley. Of course, Mark Butcher with that fantastic 170-odd. And I've got to say that I'm not quite as gloomy and pessimistic as Fuzzier about the West Indies' chances. I've got to ask Graham Swall what he thinks of West Indies' chances of both saving the game or winning the game.
Well, they're slim, but there's a chance there, and that's what they've got to believe in the change room. If I was their coach, I'd be as bullish as he is being, to be honest. So why not? I used to hate the fact that people look at history and say this is what's been done before, as if that matters. This wicket isn't the one that played them 40 years ago. The weather's not the same. The bowlers are different. I hate that, looking at history to see what's possible. What's possible is what we've seen with our own eyes. It's going to be really hard because Moeen Ali can bowl very effective off-spin, and he bowled a beauty of an over last night, and so that's planted the minds. Jimmy Anderson's closing on 500 wickets. Stuart Broad's got 400. It's a pretty tricky task. But just look at the way, you know, when Mark Butcher got that 160 here and England won that game, that's what you've got to look at. You know, when you do chase big totals, you do it with aplomb. You do it with ease normally. So I'd say to the guys, look, go out there, and any one of you in this room doesn't truly believe we can win, I don't want you in this team, I don't want you in this squad, get out.
You mentioned Jimmy Anderson. He's 3 wickets away from 500 wickets. He'd be only the third seam bowler, fast bowler, swing bowler, whatever you want to call it, after Glenn McGrath and Courtney Walsh. It's good, mate.
Call him a swing bowler.
Not a swing bowler. But do you know what I mean? I've got to categorise them other than the spinners, you know. It would be quite an achievement. Where would you put that achievement, 500 test wickets?
Well, quite simply, he's our best bowler we've had, I think. You know, I've not seen a more intelligent bowler, a more capable bowler at swinging it in or away. Obviously, I'm going to upset everyone over the age of 60 who saw all the greats bowl in the past, but you know, certainly in my lifetime, he's the most talented bowler we've got. He used to be a very effective lower-order batsman as well until... I love the stat that he went the longest in Test cricket without scoring a duck, and now he's got the joint record number of ducks with Stuart Broad for England. That's a brilliant record, and one he's probably more proud of than the fact he's just about to get 500 wickets.
I would take the view from abroad, because obviously we can sometimes, we get to know players a little bit better, perhaps lose our perspective slightly. Broad and Anderson, how are they seen from abroad and from the West Indies?
Well, certainly from the West Indies point of view, there's a tremendous amount of admiration for Jimmy Anderson, considerably less so for Stuart Broad, because he's seen as someone who just gets under the skin of everybody and gets away with it, basically. That's the bottom line, to cut a long story short. But when it comes to Jimmy Anderson, he is highly respected for the skills that he brings to the game. And even on flat pitches with nothing on offer, whether it's Grenada or any other part of the world, he just seems to persevere. He is a very competitive individual, almost abrasive and confrontational at times with the way he acts on the field. But that is similar to how the West Indies behave in our dominant era and even now. When you're on the field, when you cross the line, it's about business, it's about being competitive, it's about getting the job done. When you're off the field, it's a different story.
He's taken over 300 of those wickets in England, but I've got to point out, I think he's taken 22 wickets in the UAE at an average of 20.5, which is quite something, as Jimmy Anderson. You know him pretty well. Where do you rate him? His longevity is extraordinary. Where do you rate him in the sort of pantheon of bowlers that you've played with and against?
Oh, without doubt the best. And I think he's England's best fast bowler to have ever played the game, and you can see that by the amount of wickets that he is. He's so skillful, and he swings it both ways at will, and he's so disciplined and patient. That's why he's so successful in the subcontinent, because he's so patient. He knows exactly what he's going to do. He sets the pitch, feels right, and he bowls to it. And he's so metronomical with his accuracy. It's phenomenal with his skill and his patience, and that's why he's England's greatest bowler for me.
Well, he's going to get a chance in the morning to get those 3 wickets. He may not get too much of a chance afterwards if Moeen Ali does run through the West Indies, but as James said earlier, all 4 results are possible, and what a fantastic setup it is for the fifth day, let me remind you, the fifth day of a 5-day test, praise be. The crowd, I have to say, is not as large as I would like to see it. And I want to remind you all, it's £10 for adults, £5 for older people over 65, and students, and it's free for kids. So if you're listening and you're a loose end in the Leeds area, I know Graham thinks you should just grab a child and bring him here.
Absolutely. I think it's a very good turnout so far for day five. Your glasses half empty, isn't it?
Oval, yeah. Mate. The oval will be full.
There are still spare seats to get down here. Yeah, like I say, free babysitting. Now I'm a dad. The fact that you can bring your kids here for free all day... I'll be on that, on it like a car bonnet.
indeed. Now, before we throw back up to the studio, I just want to get the view from the three of you here. I'm going to start with James. I want your result prediction.
Throw that at me. England to win at the halfway through the final session.
Graham.
England win by tea, Moeen Ali 7-4.
Fazia.
England win just after tea.
OK, well, I'm going for a tie with Shannon Gabriel going for a wild six of the last ball of the penultimate over. Anyway, let's leave pitch side here now, as the players will very shortly be coming out. They'll be coming out in about 10 minutes, and we'll go back up to the studio where I believe Aggers and Vic Marks are waiting for us.
Indeed, thanks very much. It is frustrating, isn't it, this, really? You see the hanging around, the milling about and so on. The coaches are there, arms folded, having a conversation. They should be playing. There's no reason on earth why they shouldn't. But, of course, because you can add time on and you can claim it back again, it does give the umpires that temptation, maybe, that they should do it. But I see Trevor Bayliss down there. I don't often see him wandering around at this time of the day, but he's got a sun hat on. He's heading off nowhere in particular. And, well, sooner or later, we will get play. And there's no question, I don't think, of there being any further interruption. It's a shame for Headingley, because I think, Andrew, I was thinking this as I drove up this morning, this, clearly, five-day test match, Headingley, without so far, have we lost any time at all so far in this match up to now? I can't remember any.
Good morning.
So that's a real shame, because they would have had a clean sheet. And their marketing has been outstanding. I saw 8,000 tickets they claim to have sold for today, which would be terrific. They're not all here yet. But I think the way they've done it and they've cut the prices, I know they've got the Ashes to think about here in a couple of years' time. They want to get people into the ground, have a good time and hopefully come back and clearly pay more expensive tickets, but you know, to get people in as they've really tried to do here has to be a good thing. So anyway, that's all of that. Victor's alongside me. I noticed, Victor, I think it's been talked about already, that there's another demerit point floating about, and that Jason Holder has now picked one up. And I'm just looking at what it says here on the ICC website, and that this is not to do, I mean, it is to do with language, swearing, but not at anybody.
At himself, probably.
At himself. And indeed, this one doesn't make clear. All it says here is, during the 70th over of England's second innings, Holder, who was the bowler, made inappropriate comments in frustration, which were audible enough to be heard by the umpires. So it actually doesn't mention the pitch microphones here. It was to do with a drop catch, I think, wasn't it?
Well, I think we ought to get the person who's drafted these regulations and see what they say.
Well, there is a point here. You cannot have, in my view, you can disagree with me, you cannot have proper swearing coming out on television at home. Where whatever they're swearing about, you can't have that. However, when it comes to punishment, do you think there is a difference between swearing at a batsman or swearing at an umpire, but opposed to just swearing in front, oh no, as a catch goes down of fish cakes, where someone's dropped a catch off my bowling.
There's clearly a difference, because you're not abusing.
But what happens if both those go out on the pitch microphones?
Well, either turn the microphones off or find a mechanism of turning them off after. I don't know quite what we're gaining from the pitch mic. What is
Snicko?
Snicko. Okay, well, the third umpire.
Or Ultra Edge, or it's called these days.
Well, Ultra Edge is more of a visual thing, though, isn't it?
Well, it's
tied in together. Yeah. Okay, so the stump mic is crucial for Ultra Edge, in which case, once the ball has been delivered, is there a mechanism to turn it off if necessary?
Well, there must be, as we call in the trade, a fader.
Yeah.
In which somebody can sit, presumably.
Or you can... surely there is also the mechanism to... If this is what you want, is to make sure that a third umpire has the capacity to hear everything, such as the nick that you're desperate for, to marry up with the pictures of Ultra Edge. But does the rest of the world have to hear that?
No, I suspect.
Yeah, well, in which case, that's one solution. Yeah. But it does seem absurd to me for Jason Holder, if he's just seen a critical catch go to ground, he's not thinking about the stump mic, he's just thinking about the game. And like all of us, at some point, when something goes wrong, he says something, which you don't want kids at home to listen to, or anyone at home to listen to. But it seems preposterous that he should get closer to being suspended.
Yes, as Stokes is too. The same sort of situation.
It's crazy. That's where I am on that.
Well,
I think most players are, or ex-players.
There must be a way of being able to cut off the sound from the middle once the ball has passed the bat or whatever it is. There must be somebody somewhere who can just flick a switch or something, and that's his job, and that's it. But to be for players to face suspension for actually, you know, verbal abuse is a different matter. Of course, you don't want that in the game. But just a frustrated.
Yeah. Ugh. Expletive.
Indeed. I think people have grown up enough to accept that happens in all sorts of walks.
Maybe they're going to have a look at it, but at how they use those regulations, maybe they'll change them. I don't know, but it just seems a bit crazy.
There's a good job there wasn't a pitch mic in my car last night, I can tell you.
Well, did something go wrong?
Well, yes. I was traveling along quite happily, 50 miles an hour, behaving my own self. And it was like a rifle had gone off in my car. And then massive bang. Hence the audible expletive.
Yes.
And I thought, what is that? And it's got a sunroof on the top. And the whole thing had sort of shattered.
Really?
Yes.
And something hit it?
No, it hadn't. Because you can run your hand over the top of it, and it's completely smooth. You can run your hand underneath it, and it's completely smooth. Somehow within this, it just went bang! So I had a phone call to the garage. I was having a bit of a discussion, I think, about how who's liable for this. But it was a huge... huge rifle shot going off. But anyway, there you go. That was an audible
not
expletive.
Not deleted.
I would have been in the ICC's dressing room on that.
And demerit point. At least one.
I think I might have got a couple, actually. Still, I feel
here.
Better. I am. So we've got flag waving, we've got Jerusalem, and we have this disappointing delay to the start. But it is going to be very brief. But I just feel a bit sorry, the fact that it's the only delay that Headingley has had in 5 full days. And given that that's not always the case here, that's a shame. But it had a clean sheet. But that's not going to stop people coming in.
No. The good news is that you don't actually lose any overs.
No.
Because who knows? I mean, it's highly unlikely, but maybe the West Indies will want those overs at 6:30 tonight or whenever it is.
Well, our guest interviewee of 2 tea times ago, Ray Illingworth.
Yes.
But of course, we've been looking to bowl him out and win the game. But he always had up his sleeve, and I always so loved his captaincy for this. Just that little thought of keeping the batting side ever so slightly interested, knowing when he'd just got to tantalise them a little bit. He'd bring on Chris Balderston for a couple of overs.
I think.
And just keep them positively looking at it.
That's right. I mean, I suspect that happened more often in county cricket than in Test cricket. There was a famous Test match, thinking of Raymond here, in 1969, which I looked at yesterday, where the West Indies needed 303 to win, and they fell 30 short, and Raymond was captain. And I meant to talk to Alan Knott about it, and he remembered that game specifically because of the way Illy had masterminded lots of bowling changes for particular batsmen, particular situations. He had some good bowlers. He had himself and he had Derek Underwood for a start, plus John Snow and one or two others. But Notty used that as an example, how Illy was sort of like a puppeteer pulling the strings. Clive Lloyd came into bat, so he probably took Deadly off fairly quickly, much more quickly than you expect, to bowl himself because he was just turning it slowly away from Clive Lloyd, etc. And it was a lovely little masterclass from Notty, who thought the world of Ray Illingworth.
Yep. No, great loyalty there. And earned as such, too. Here come the West Indies, then. Really good atmosphere here. So I was reading that they sold 8,000 tickets. That's a really good effort, if that turns out to be the case. It's a tenner for adults, nothing for kids.
There's lots of people that you can't see very easily from where you're sitting. If I lean over, just sort of long off down there.
Excellent news.
That stand is almost full. The Western... What do we call it now? I forget now. Western
all
Stand.
All sorts of things. It's the Western Terrace, West Stand, or it's the White Rose.
The middle tier, the middle section is filling up. They're obviously keeping the side sections empty for the moment. But it's been a good test match for Yorkshire County Cricket Club, I think. They've got a good surface. I don't think they control the weather up here, but they've found some good weather and a good game.
And good pricing.
Yeah.
Well, Moe's the man for me. I suspect. I think he could win this game for England here. But for now, it's Jimmy Anderson. And if you had to, all those years ago, say, well, Jimmy, you are on 497 Test wickets. You are going to be at Headingley. You are going to be under the sort of skies that have just created a 15-minute interruption.
Not bad.
There's been some rain and drizzle first thing, and you've got the West Indies. I think that almost ticks all the boxes that he would have.
He's also got a couple of people he's tormented. I mean, Kieran Powell has struggled against him. He's found the outside edge. Alastair Cook and the slip cordon, red alert.
Here's the first ball of the day, the last day. West Indies need 317 more to win, and Anderson bowls it outside the off stump, and Powell rather tentatively prods at that, and the ball goes past the outside edge into Jonny Bairstow's gloves. There are four slips there. Moeen's loosening up at backward point. He played beautifully yesterday. We were that little bit of luck with the no-ball situation, but it's been that sort of game. There's been all these little caveats about the match in which, in a lot of ways, the quality of the cricket's been pretty disappointing, but it's still produced a really interesting game of cricket, and that's often the way. Five for no wicket. Anderson dips his head, runs in past the umpire, bowls, and that's turned away into the leg side. The first run for the West Indies today, possibly a leg bye. Let's watch Mr. Gaffney, who's bracing himself, raises his right leg and taps it a couple of times. So West Indies up to six for no wicket. Their target is 322. And now the field changes around for the right-handed Brathwaite. And I don't think the field will change too much. They're still looking like four slips. Brathwaite marks his guard in the Chanderpaul way by knocking the end of a bale into the ground.
He must have watched Chanderpaul as a kid.
Must have been.
That.
He was the first person to ever see do it.
Yeah,
his little trademark way. Four slips waiting then. Anderson to the right-handed Brathwaite. Hit on the pad, appeal for leg before wicket. He wants that. Umpire Gaffney says no. And I must admit, it didn't look quite right from here, if I'm honest. It's a very short conversation taking place there with Bairstow and Root. And they've decided no review.
He may not want to do this, Jimmy Anderson, but I think you make an excellent umpire. Actually, I always thought Swanee would make a very good umpire, but perhaps temperamentally he's not suited for 6 months on the county circuit.
Well, I was going to mention also the question of swearing into pitch mics. You might have the first umpire.
I forgot that bit.
The first umpire.
Well, that's interesting, because we learned, this is a valid point we'll mention.
OK. Anderson on his way. Bowls outside the off stump and no stroke. Well, he's been beaten again there outside the off stump.
It's only quite recently the third umpire has been mic'd up, and they decided to do it certainly in the World Cup. And we came across dear old gunner Ian Gould, who said they decided they're not going to put me on third umpire duty because they can't trust my language.
That's right.
Can umpires get demerit points?
Well, I suspect they must be able to.
And it was a fair point, and he understood.
Anderson bowls, and that hits Brathwaite on the pad, is picked up by Moeen, trotting in enthusiastically from mid-wicket. Clearer to our left, but it's still
looking for
darkish cloud. It's very still.
It's not a bad day to bowl.
It's a lovely day to bowl. A lovely day to bowl. It really is. It's almost floodlights on material, but they haven't turned them on yet. But it's that, 50-50, really. Anderson bowls, Brathwaite's beaten by one that reared outside the off stump, left him, and that's given him something to think about. And he's doing some gardening, tapping away there at the end of his bat, but that one bounced and then flew and went through about chest height through to Bairstow. It really went, did. That's a lovely sight as a bowler, especially on a last day when you often see the ball king rather low and you think, there's not much in here for me. But he'll like that. The umpires are having a chat, and I wonder if it is actually about the floodlights, actually. Mr. Gaffney's searching, fumbling around, I think, for his mouthpiece. And now Stuart Broad will bowl from this end. I worry about Broad's outswing. I know there are larger things in life one should fret about.
Well, you can worry about his outswing to the right-hander.
I don't think he's got it anymore.
No. Well, he bowls so effectively to left-handers nowadays from almost exclusively from around the wicket.
Yeah.
And he's looking to swing it away. And you probably talk to him far more often than us. And I suspect he's a bit worried about that.
Yeah. Away but this, I think this is part of the reason why it's gone.
Yeah, yeah.
He gets himself so much in this in-swing position.
Yeah.
And it's an easier position to get in once you're in it.
I mean, the only virtue is, or the only consolation is, there's so many left-handers around that he's become a sort of specialist away swinger to left-handers only.
But I'd much rather see him going over the wicket and bringing the ball into his into his pads.
Bringing LBW into the process occasionally. Absolutely. Well, Jimmy Anderson doesn't bowl many in-swingers to left-hander now.
But I think it has affected Broad's outswing. Anyway, he's going round the wicket now. In he goes, bowls to Powell. There's an edge and it's four. Through third man, looking to hit the ball through mid-on. And there's no one down at third man apart from a young steward, or maybe a photographer. He's got some sort of bib on down there. And Rashindis moves to 10 for no wicket. But you can tell, looking as we could there at the replay, that the angle of the seam was absolutely for an in-swinger or an out-swinger to the left-hander.
Well, for left-handers, I mean, that's fine, isn't it? You want some LBWs as well?
I'd much rather see him come over the wicket. And then you can still push one across. But you're getting that ball coming in, you're trapping them, so you can't plant that pad. 10 for no wicket. Four slips waiting, hands on knees. Broad, down the slope, runs in, bowls, and he's pushing forward again, getting a leading edge, outside edge anyway, out to point. And they take another run, 11 for no wicket. And now he's going to come over the wicket to the right-hander. Well, let's see if he can get the ball to go away, because any breeze that there is will be coming up from fine leg. And let's just see if he can get the outswingers. He's got the four slips lined up. Otherwise, get a short leg and keep going with that in-swing. But short leg at the moment is back at mid-wicket.
He's what's he doing? Joe Root and Stuart Broad are just discussing what to do with the man at square leg. They've got the helmet out there, but he's not going to plonk it on, I don't think. He's where is he going? He's in our Australian position of leg gully.
He is. He's a backward square leg, isn't he? 11 for no wicket. Brathwaite on four is ready now. A slightly open stance as Broad, with the makings of a shadow at his feet, is on his way and bowls to him. It's outside the off stump. That sort of channel, I would call that, and Brathwaite's beaten. Swing particularly, but it was more of the line, I think, that defeated him there. He might have been sort of playing for one that might come into him a little bit.
Yeah, well, maybe it went slightly off the pitch. Or maybe he was anticipating in-swing and it was a straight ball.
I think that was more like it, a bit of a scrambled scene. Just seen a picture on the telly, they're starting them young here in the fancy dress department. We've got a mother with two very young children. He's come as a pirate, and she's some sort of goblin or elf or something, sitting over there on the west stand. Here comes Broad, bowls on off stump, played across that, out into the onside. 11 for no wicket. Lots of oohs and ahs, and the pressure really on these bats when they've got to start well. They've got to give West Indies a platform. Can they win it? Well, they can, but they're going to have wickets in hand at tee. And even then, the field could be set back. It'd be a very tall order. Someone would have to get in and really dominate to the point that field placings are difficult to set and so on. 11 for no wicket. Here's Broad. Bowls to Brathwaite. That's a good one. That did just shape away a little bit.
Yeah.
And
that's a good ball.
He pushed at it. Applause from the crowd.
It's a lovely length. And even though it's not huge speed, it's about 83 miles an hour, but there was a bit of zip off the pitch.
Yep.
That went off the pitch. Good to see Bairstow taking it around above hip high there.
Julian asks, how many demerit points did you get after your horse riding lesson number 3 when I was thrown off?
Right.
That would have been a lengthy suspension, Julian. I did make a good point from Rupert that rugby union's done well with the ref mics and so on. You don't hear, you know, that is a very physical, full-on game. Here's Broad bowling on the off stump. Pushed up to cover, you know, it's sort of education. They learn that they can't swear with mics around and so on. So it doesn't, it very rarely happens in rugby union. 11 for no wicket, two overs gone. And Brathwaite has four, Powell has six. More from Victor, and then it'll be Simon.
They haven't tried it in soccer yet. They might just wait a bit longer. But it against the odds, the referee having a microphone has worked, I think, pretty well in rugby union, partly because it's explained to one and all some of the refereeing decisions. It's such an arcane game in some ways, and some of the laws and regulations and what you can and can't do. It's helped a little bit. And also, the referees are always incredibly articulate.
Good morning, Victor. Here's Anderson moving into bowl. That's down the leg side to Powell, who shapes to turn it away and misses. It's taken by Bairstow, then flicks it back to the slips just to make sure they're all paying attention. Brathwaite, 4. Powell, 6.
I can't remember the name, but there was a French referee doing the England-Italy game, wasn't there, last season, when Italy had a cunning ploy of not engaging in the rucks. It completely befuddled the England team, who started asking the referee questions, and he said, "I am not your coach."
That's right, yeah. I can't remember who it was. Yeah, I remember
it was
that,
one
yeah.
of the French ones.
Yeah. Anderson, the football stand end, moves in to bowl to Powell, and Powell is forward, playing that competently enough, up towards mid-off, and there is no run. Well, we've been lobbying for the third umpire to be heard to explain his decisions as well.
And that's happened.
Which is good.
That shouldn't be too treacherous, although I've just mentioned the... I see Gunnar Gould actually has been doing a third umpire job somewhere around the world. He might even be in Bangladesh.
Right, well, the latest news from Bangladesh is this. Australia need a further 213 runs to win with 8 wickets remaining. Anderson bowls to Powell, and Powell tries to turn it their way, struck on the pad. Bairstow comes behind the stumps to his right to pick up, and there is no run.
Who's
they are 51 Warner? For 2. No, Warner's still in.
Still there.
Warner and Smith are together.
Well, these are the crucial moments. You've got to get those two out.
Slightly worryingly for Bangladesh, Warner is 40 not out of 49 balls with 7 fours and a 6. Smith is 5 not out, so he's obviously taken.
Who's got the wickets?
Mahady's got one, and Shakib has got one.
It's a very good game, and we can picture it. We know it'll be turning there.
Mm. Here goes Anderson, looking for wicket 498, and it's nicely driven by Powell. Firm drive up to mid-on, tumbling save by Broad. Slightly incongruously, he's wearing a sun hat on an overcast day, but I promise the sun will be out later. Yeah, Australia 54 for 2, they need 210 more to win. Bangladesh 260 and 221. Australia 217 and 54 for 2. Nathan Lyon took another 6 wickets.
He'll be catching up with Shane soon.
Keeps playing in Bangladesh, they will. 11 for no wicket. 9th over the innings. Anderson bowls. That's Alex Powell on the pad. And down the leg side. Bairstow after it again. And picks up, and there's no run. You can see how the tickets have been sold today in the West Stand. It's a block in the middle. With spectators, then no one either side. I suppose if people come along as the day goes on, that might fill up.
We're saving on stewards, probably.
Yeah.
You always never quite know who's going to turn up, do you, at the end of a test match? Even though it's crazy, really. Why would you leave a play but not go to the last act, you know? Or go to a play.
Here's Anderson bowling. Yes, forward comes Powell and plays that firmly up towards mid-off, where it's picked up by Woakes, and there is no run. And Anderson maiden. And it's 11 for no wicket after 9 overs. Roddy Eswick, the West Indies bowling coach, was in bullish mood last night. Dan was interviewing him, suggesting, well, it's, you know, the game has slipped away from you. He said, what? You know, you're talking as if we can't win the game. And of course, in terms of runs per over and wickets in hand, it's perfectly possible.
Well, they keep quoting 1984, don't they? Not the book. But the Lord's Testament.
Big Brother is watching you in your changing room.
Yeah, well, how right was that? But the 344, wasn't it, Andrew, that they needed, and they got them in 66 overs.
That's right, yeah. If West Indies were to win this, it would be the fourth highest total they've ever chased successfully in Test cricket.
They've got the highest, haven't
they? They've got the highest,
against
4 and 8.
Australia.
Yeah. Mm. It would be the third highest ever chased in England. And it would be the seventh time a team had chased 300 on the final day. Scored 300 or more on the final day to win a test.
Broad bowls outside of Brathwaite's off stump. There is no stroke.
Well, of course, as recently as 1948, the Aussies knocked off 404 here.
They did, which is the most anyone's ever... Well, it's the third... What's it? The third, fourth highest, I think, now in successful run chase. It was some... It's the highest anyone's made on the final day to win a test match. But they did face 114 overs to do that.
How many times have England conceded as many as 322 to lose a test match? There's a game, very famous game in
Chennai. Headligey 1948.
Yes, yeah, that's one. Chennai.
Was it more than 320?
Yeah, that was about 380, wasn't it? 385. Broad goes in and bowls, and Brathwaite forced into defence on the back foot. Runs away out towards extra cover, well, and there's no run.
There's the other thing about declarations. It's very rare, but we've got two instances. I think England declared in 1948. They certainly declared in Chennai. Mm. But it's not often people declare in test matches and lose.
No.
Sobers, famously. Gilchrist, Headingley. It's not often, but we've got four without thinking.
Yeah. Well, that's probably because they're so exactly. Famous. Yeah. Floodlights coming on here. Broad goes in and bowls full. It's driven, not really timed. Goes to extra cover. Picked up by Woakes, who hurls it into Bairstow, and there's no run. It's quite bright over the centre of Leeds, but over Headingley, it's murky. So I decided to put the lights on. Andrew.
This would be the fourth highest England had conceded to lose a test match. There was the 404, the 344, and the 389 in Chennai that you mentioned.
So those were three, yeah.
And 12 teams have won after a declaration in the third innings, which includes that famous game in Centurion in 2000, which...
Can we count that?
Was a bit contrived.
Was it?
That's a South African euphemism, I think.
Basically, yes.
Four slips go down. Broad moves in and bowls to Brathwaite, and Brathwaite turns this away slightly uppishly. There's a short leg had been in there. It might well have been a catch, but there isn't. There's a square leg. And he picked it up, and there is no run.
So 12 times Test captains have declared and lost, is that all?
Yeah.
That's not very many, is it, in goodness knows how many years?
Including Centurion.
Including Centurion.
I'll put
an asterisk next to Centurion.
I'm writing this down.
The most recent one being the one in Chennai that you mentioned in 2008.
England declared
on 3-1-1 for 9, yeah.
When India beat West Indies in Jamaica, do you remember with 400, was that a declaration?
No, it was Trinidad. It was a declaration, yes.
Oh. Here's Broad going into bowl to Brathwaite, and that snakes past the outside edge of the ball. That swung away. Broad stands in the middle of the pitch, can't believe his luck. Good delivery to Brathwaite, who played at it. He didn't get that close to it. It went such a long way.
I've got Fazio's on it, but it was in Trinidad. And Gavaskar got lots.
Yeah, they didn't declare that one.
It didn't declare. Hang on, I've got to leave this. I'm going to leave you and Fazio to sort it out.
They did declare. I'm looking at the wrong place. I'll give you some details on that now.
That was the sort of precursor to the let's play four pacemen.
Broad bowls edged and dropped by Cook at first slip.
Oh.
And it's gone for four as well. It went quickly. It wasn't the hardest slip catch because it was around about chest height, just to his left. One of those you'd expect Cook to catch. And a life for Brathwaite. Broad finding the outside edge of the bat. He takes his sun hat and sweater from the umpire, and he looks as if the world is against him. He's looking up at the big screen and wondering how Cook dropped that. And there you are. From the crowd as they see it on the big screen.
Well, it's my impression that in recent times, Broad rather than Anderson has suffered rather more from drop catches. Mm. And I think Broad probably agrees with me on that one.
Yeah.
It went quickly, but Cook has a good record at first slip. He's made himself into a very good first slip, but he just didn't seem to pick that up, and it ended up flicking his fingers and carrying on. So an uncharacteristic error from Cook, and Broad, not for the first time in this match, is a little disgruntled.
Mm. It happened a couple of times. Edgbaston, finally it came good for him, going past Ian Botham. That was the end of the over. It's 15 for no wicket. Powell is on strike. Anderson bowls, and that's gone for four as well. Down to fine leg. It's brushed away by Brathwaite. Anderson losing his line there. There's a couple in the previous over that was leg stumpish that Powell wasn't able to deal with. And that one was turned away, and it went past Bairstow. Absolutely no chance for the fine leg fielder. So West Indies with back-to-back boundaries are 19 for no wicket.
Port of Spain in 76, West Indies declared probably about halfway through the fourth day. India chasing 400, well, England 406 for four. They won by 6 wickets. Gavaskar and Vishwanath both making hundreds.
Jack Clive Lloyd?
Yeah, Clive Lloyd is the captain.
Yeah, and that's when they said enough's enough, didn't they?
Well, listen.
Here's Anderson bowling outside the off stump this time. No strike from Powell.
Two of those 4 wickets are runouts as well.
And quite a lot of overs bowled by spin. Of course, Trinidad was renowned for spinning.
Three frontline spinners, two debutants.
Yeah. who weren't quite as good as they thought they were. Yeah.
And then things started to change.
Yeah. India really did fellow batsmen around the world no service at all by knocking those off.
19 for no wicket. Anderson bowls outside of the off stump of Powell again. And Powell lets it go by. It's taken by Bairstow.
Look at Broad. He's got his hands on his head. He can't quite believe it. He's just trying to compose himself. And Alastair Cook is also looking a little gloomy. Look at Broad. He's almost in a trance there at mid-off, trying to gather himself.
It's a bit early in the day to feel the whole world is against you there, but I'm sure he's not thinking that at the moment.
No, I think you can do it, Simon.
Can
it? Yeah.
And he's still in that pose at mid-on.
Someone hit him. Come out. He's like Bob Willis at Headingley.
Well, that's probably a good thing. Anderson goes into bowl to Powell outside the off stump again, and no stroke from Powell, and it's through to Bairstow. Looking around for Graham Swan. Oh, yeah. There's one thing, when you say Graham Swan would make a great umpire. Mm-hmm. CMJ used to say that, didn't he? Because he was very good on the, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think many games will start on time necessarily.
Well, there might be a few more 11:15 starts. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, we had a bit of rain earlier. We'll start a bit later.
But no, I've always thought watching him up here, he knew what was out and what wasn't out. And Anderson's very good too.
Anderson to Powell, and Powell gets one that's a bit closer to off stump, and it flies through as well. But Powell's able to leave it.
And the great thing is about that is that the umpires, quite good umpires, they get to know which. Bowlers, they can get a bit of a union, and they can tell from the bowler who they begin to trust the bowler's judgment, so that you've got two sorts of appeals. You've got the one that's out, isn't it? Yeah. And then you've got the appeal is, well, that could be out.
Yeah.
Anyway, here he is.
I saw this.
I think he'd do the game a service if he went on the umpire's list. I really do.
This is Anderson bowling to Powell, again outside the off stump, not far away from that off stump, but good judgment from Powell, letting that one go through to Bairstow. And it's not an Anderson maiden this time, because the ball was flicked for four off the first ball. 19 for no wicket, 322 the target. Well, we mentioned the Australia score a few minutes ago, but they're 56 for two now, needing 209 more to beat Bangladesh. Warner is 44 not out. I got Swanee and umpiring. I got an insight into the way he must have played the game. I think you probably admitted it actually on last Thursday when there was an LBW shout. You said, "Oh no, you're right. Actually, I shouldn't have appealed for that because that was."
No, I didn't appeal. I didn't appeal for that because it was missing leg. You know, that's what I said.
Did you? Mm. Yeah, I'm not going to appeal for that, John. It was just going down.
Just going down, exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, your best friend, the umpires. I never understand bowlers.
No, I agree.
Get angry with the umpires, no. Jimmy.
Here's Broad bowling outside the off stump. No stroke from Brathwaite. Plenty of encouragement for Broad out there. That catch dropped in the previous over. At the moment, he's perhaps just looking a bit more likely than Jimmy, who's been bowling wide of off stump or down the leg side a little. And how long before we see Moeen today? Would he be your first change?
Absolutely. It's a shame that catch has gone down because, you know, Stuart Broad, when he gets his tail up, he gets an early wicket, tends to go bang, 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 doesn't he? It's a beautiful ball as well.
Yeah, got four slips in and a deepish leg gully. It's full, this one, though. There's no mid-off. And it's driven up towards the long-off boundary. Woakes is after it. It's tantalising him, but it gets there just in time. Four runs. Firm push down the ground. I mean, normally, you know, straight to mid-off, but Broad is bowling without a mid-off.
Yeah, understandably. Can afford to attack. He got plenty of runs. Brathwaite's not a massively attacking player. You know why Cook has dropped that, don't you? The kiss of death put in him by this box the other day. Everyone said, what a great pair of hands and how safe he is. The cricketing gods are always listening. Mm. Just didn't get anywhere near it, did he? Hit him on the end of the fingers. And almost if you were surprised by the pace of it.
It flew a bit, but it was very catchable. Chest height, just to his left.
Yeah. It's like in a war movie, like the guy's just about to get on an airplane saying, as soon as I get back, I'm going to propose to my young sweetheart.
Ball bowls full. That's dug out into the offside, this time straight to Woakes at extra cover, and there's no run.
It's the kiss of death, isn't it? He's not coming back.
No.
In fact, Cookie is a bit like that. He believes in stuff like that, so he will... He wouldn't have had anything to do that. He'd never say, like, oh, I'm in good nick, I'm going to get runs tomorrow. I'm batting so well at the minute.
He doesn't want to tempt the cricketing
gods.
Don't
tempt fate. No. Never do it.
Floodlights beaming down on this overcast morning. England yet to make the breakthrough. We've had 25 minutes play very nearly. Broad goes in and bowls just outside the off stump. This is pushed up towards mid-off as well. Woakes is after it. And Brathwaite gets a single. Just a firm push, really. Normally it wouldn't be one, but England operating without the mid-off. Perhaps just tempting that drive from Brathwaite. 24 for no wicket. West Indies happy enough with this start. Of course, we did start quarter an hour late today, but we will make up all the overs. You've got to bowl all the overs today. Well, by hook or by crook, as long as the light's okay, of course. So we could go
should
through
be with
to...
with the floodlights as well.
Floodlights, and I think the forecast for later is for a bit of sunshine as well. I mean, we could go through to, you know, whatever time, 7 o'clock, 7.15, till all 90 overs have been bowled. Broad bowls round the wicket, and that's a lovely shot from Powell, driving it firmly down the ground for four. Well, if Broad feels the world's against him this morning, that won't improve his mood. No chance for Woakes at mid-on. Drilled down the ground. Excellent stroke from Powell. Takes him to 14. And West Indies now 28 for no. Where's Powell in this
really
series?
Was a good shot. Powell's nowhere in this series, I can tell you that, without you even looking at his scores. He's been a walking wicket for Jimmy Anderson, hasn't he? Caught in the slips.
20 and 10 in the first test, and then 5. So he's
going Anderson
down, 20,
all three
10,
games.
5. Anderson in the first innings here. Moeen Ali, Anderson in the second innings, Edgbaston. And then, of course, the run out. Well, Jimmy,
the run out.
Jimmy Anderson as well.
Yeah.
28 for no wicket. Powell with, 5 slips behind him. Just waits. Broad is fiddling with the ball at the moment. Well, there's a bit of debris on it, and he's getting rid of that. And he puts it in his fingers and sets off into bowl to the left-handed Powell. And he slides one past his outside edge, flies through to Bairstow. Good response from Broad. And England yet to take a wicket in the first 25 minutes play. 28 for no wicket then. The target, remember, 322 to level the series. It's time for Fazia.
What I can tell you this morning... in the warm-ups, I was down on the field. England are very buoyed, very up for this game. They play football every morning as a warm-up. Some of the quality on display today, Fizzy. I don't know if you saw them playing. Joe Root scored the best goal I've ever seen from a Yorkshireman. Moeen Ali again in good nick. Jimmy Anderson, fine game. Alastair Cook sat the game out because he's got a poorly knee in this game. That might be the reason he dropped the catch. Maybe he's not alive and electric like the rest of them. Stuart Broad scored a good goal as well. It was a high-class game.
There are lots of excuses to be found for all the catches that have been dropped, and certainly from the West Indies' point of view as well. You get the sense they enjoy football a lot more than cricket.
Absolutely.
As Anderson in now bowls, and he's following that, guiding it away for four. So the luck has been going for the West Indies. The boundaries have been flowing as well. Another four to Kraigg Brathwaite, put down at slip off the bowling of Stuart Broad. He's on 17. Powell is 14. The West Indies 32 without loss. And yeah, even with the West Indies, they may not be as energetic as you would see from the English. But certainly, when they are out for their warm-ups and playing a bit of football, they clearly enjoy it a lot more than the cricket.
Well, the grass is always greener, isn't it? Everyone wants to do what they don't. I'd love to think of, some of the big teams of the world, Barcelona or Real Madrid, Newcastle United, or playing cricket in the changing room beforehand to get out of there. Come on, lads, warm up. One-on-one bounce.
You've just made a former West Indies opening batsman a very, very happy man, and I'll tell you why after this delivery from Jimmy Anderson. Three slips and a gully, backward point, mid-off, mid-on, square leg and a long leg, and he's tucked up by one that jags into him and rolls away on the offside. Brian Davis, who is the head of cricket at the Queen's Park Cricket Club, former opening batsman, played against Australia in 1965. He hates the idea of cricketers playing football before a cricket match. And he says, as soon as he sees a football team playing cricket before they go out onto the field for a football game, then you can do all you want with these football warm-ups. I suppose they'll say he's one of those old cobwebby type
old
individuals who see things only a certain way. But Brian, you've just had a fan. As Anderson bowls a good delivery that squares him up as he struck in front. He's asking the question. Might have been just outside the line. He's taking a definite step forward and probably outside the off stump. Are they going to ask the question?
No,
Anderson,
I don't think they are. They
is
don't
looking
look.
Towards Bairstow. They're hesitating a bit. Root is saying, well, okay, tell me, what do you do? And they decided at the end not to do it.
Whenever you see England in these situations, Joe always looks He always looks as if he wants someone to be firm and say, no, call for the third umpire. And he looks at Jimmy. That was outside the line, so it was a good shout by them, but not to call it. But he always looks like he wants someone to be firm, say, no, Joe, you should definitely do that. He enjoys it when Mo's bowling, because Mo's straight away goes, no, you've got to. So he does. Doesn't like Jimmy sitting on the fence.
Here goes Anderson again, passes the umpire, bowls a full-length delivery that's driven away towards the onside by Brathwaite. He is on 17, Powell on 14. The West Indies, 5 without loss overnight. They've gone at a good rate, courtesy of a few boundaries, courtesy of the drop catch at slip that went away for 4 off the fingers of Alastair Cook. Brathwaite benefiting from that life to the bowling of Stuart Broad, and quite admirably, he didn't utter an audible obscenity when that happened. And was seeming to do the very best to restrain himself, even standing at mid-on for the next over. And he's standing there as well at almost an extra cover as he waits on Anderson. High cloud, bowls and beats Brathwaite again. That's going to happen very often, as it did on the second morning when the West Indies were in a lot of trouble. They were 35 for 3 at one point, and then had that big double century partnership between Brathwaite and Shai Hope. And it's not surprising that they are playing and missing so often on this final morning.
Yeah, it's not an easy wicket to battle now. It still looks really good between the stumps. But there is a bit of movement there. The bounce has remained fairly consistent, which has been very impressive from this Headligey pitch. It used to be a bit up and down. Bounce has been good, but there really is some lateral movement now.
Anderson races in, bowls to Brathwaite. He's on the back foot, short of a length, and that's where Brathwaite will be most comfortable, on that back foot on this last day pitch to Anderson. Plays it away towards the offside. Warm applause for a testing over from Jimmy Anderson, but still no success for England with the West Indies. Set that target of 322. They are 290 runs away at 32 without loss.
Yeah, Jimmy Anderson not happy with the footholds there as well, kicking away at the ground. You can often find with fast bowlers, if their rhythm isn't quite right, it only takes a little movement of the foot when you slam it down. If it just slides a centimetre or so, it can really upset your rhythm, upset your length more than anything. I know I used to hate it, and you have to ask Jonathan when you get someone that's like for a fast bowler, but Jimmy's not happy. I think he's bowling slightly short because of it, and he's not really happy with that at all. Get Mo on.
5 slips in place. I wonder if they're too close together, those 5 slips, but there they are. Backward point, mid-off, mid-on, square leg, as Broad bowls full length, wide outside the off stump to the left-handed Karen Powell. It remains at 32 without loss. And yes, all of the references to when West Indies would have chased big totals, even as when Dan was interviewing the bowling coach, Roddy Estwick, talked about that 344 for one. But I know you hate that, because that's ancient history. It's a totally different time, different period, different game, different situation entirely. But the West Indies might take heart from that. But does it really matter at this stage? Is
it really doesn't.
Point?
You've just got to believe you can chase anything down, regardless of what's been done or not been done in the past.
Broad bowls a full-length delivery that goes past the outside edge, and it's through to the keeper, just in the same way that no one has ever scored 2 centuries in the same first-class match ever at Headingley. Now is the time for one for the West Indies. You've got Kraigg Brathwaite, and if not him, why not Shai Hope?
Well, that's the whole point. If records
there's
are there,
always the first time.
If records aren't there to be broken, then what's the point of them? I've got to say, very good crowd here filling up at Headingley. There's 2 sections of the Western Terrace that haven't been opened as of yet. But I put it to the people of Yorkshire that you can fill that up, no problem.
Broad with a bit of sunshine now, bowls, and he's driving fluently. Didn't time it as well as he wanted, peeling away off the out half of the bat, but will run away for 4 nevertheless. Probably looking to go through extra cover, Karen Powell, but he picks up 4 more, continuing to play positively. He's on 18, and the West Indies now 36 without loss.
Yeah, playing with a bit of fluency as well, Powell. He's had a very poor series. He must just be delighted to be down the other end to Jimmy Anderson every time. This was nice. He leaned back a little bit, but he can afford. There's a very aggressive field set by England. You mentioned about the slips being too close together. Actually, I'm with you on that. They're quite close to the crease, because they have to be. Day 5, the wicket's not really that quick, and you have to squeeze a little bit closer, but they're almost in each other's pockets.
Yeah, it goes broader. The balls are to Paul, shoulders, arms, lets it go by through to the keeper. He hasn't had the best return to international cricket, Karen Powell. Drifted away from the game when he was dropped following a test match in Jamaica against New Zealand, which the West Indies lost in 2014. Just simply walked away from the game and was actually trying his hand at baseball, Major League Baseball. He had some tryouts with the New York Mets last year.
Did he really?
That didn't actually work out. Then he came back to play for the Leeward Islands. He's from the island of Nevis, the Twin Island Federation of St. Kitts Nevis. As he waits on Broad, it's continuing into him again. This time he's pushing defensively, but will get the single. Well played to the right of extra cover and moves on to 19. The total goes up to 37 without loss. But he got the call back into the team when he scored over 500 runs for the Leeward Islands, including three centuries in the regional 50-over one-day competition, the regional Super 50, as it's known. Then he was back into the England team, into the West Indies team for the one-dayers against England, and then back into the Test team. Hasn't really set the world alight. His best would have been 49 against Pakistan in Jamaica. Yes, Antle?
That's right, yeah. 196 runs at 21.7 in five Tests before this innings, since he's come back.
And just about due for a decent score. Broad now bowls to Brathwaite on leg stump, and he's turning it away. Forward or square. Will get a couple of runs here. This is an encouraging effort from the West Indies at the top of the order, but there's such a long way to go and there's such an air of vulnerability about their batting that they'll be really hoping they get some solidity through the first 2 hours, an hour and 45 minutes this morning. 39 without loss, Brathwaite on 19, Powell also on 19. A famous song, no, 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 19 about the West
Mike
Indies.
Mike Hardcastle.
Yeah.
God. Andrew Sampson's trying to encourage Fazir to sing that one.
No way. 39 without loss. Brathwaite on 19. Powell on 19.
I've just had a sweet whisper in my ear from the producer that there was a cricket takeoff by Rory Bremner. I don't remember that.
Yeah, and that's the one that I remember.
Oh, I was doing the actual, the real one.
Yeah, that's right. I think the batting average of England in that 1984 series was 19.
Oh, there we go.
Four slips, backward point, mid-off.
David Gower's average mid-off in the series, apparently, 19 in 84.
Forward square leg. And the average of somebody else was 126. Anderson racing in again, looking for the breakthrough for England, lifting delivery, but he doesn't have a forward short leg, so Paul can just play that off the hip very comfortably towards the forward square leg.
I'm intrigued by this. I'm going to have to find it. The only England song I can remember was when they went to the West Indies in 1990. It was the Sky Sports first time they covered it. It's this song that no one else remembers that goes, young lions are gonna roar, England's team must give it all. It was brilliant.
Mercifully, I don't remember.
It was like a rock song. Mm. That'll be on YouTube somewhere. I'll find those later.
I'm sure it is. Everything's on YouTube. Anderson bowls on the line of leg stump, turned away towards forward square leg. There is no run, so just looking to get into play across the line. Karen Powell, the left-hander, went to the Millfield School for a spell.
Did he?
Yeah, public school boy.
Well, there's normally a Millfield school boy in or around every first-class cricket team in England. Just churn them out from there. Oakham and Millfield churn out first-class cricketers, as does Radley.
Why do they call private schools public schools?
No idea. I think it goes back hundreds of years.
Okay. A bit more sunshine. As Anderson bowls short of a length, turned away on the onside, out towards the mid-on. There is no run once again. 39 without loss. The West Indies from the overnight 5 without loss.
Yeah, to make things more confusing, we have public schools, which tend to be the old-fashioned, the famous
Eton Harrow sort of thing, yeah.
And then we have private schools, which are other schools you pay for. But then we have state schools.
So the public schools are the posh private schools.
Yes, basically. And it's normally in England, you can normally find, you look through the batsmen and they're all public schools. They all paid to go to school and the bowlers are all state school boys.
The old gentleman players sort of thing.
Yeah.
Here's Anderson round the wicket now. Bowls to Powell and squares him up. Gets runs again. Four more. No gully in place despite all the slips. And it's really a case of perseverance and discipline for England and not being frustrated by these edges that are going away, by the catch that has been put down off Stuart Broad. And the West Indies won't mind. They are 43 without loss. Brathwaite 19 and Powell with that latest boundary up to 23.
I'm intrigued here about this baseball, Charlie, when I haven't been to MetLife Stadium this year, this winter. played a game of cricket there. Sachin Tendulkar and Shane Warne's All-Stars cricket we played there. With minute boundaries, Shoaib Akhtar on 100 mile an hour bounces at Matty Hayden. It was great fun.
That was in the winter of 2015. They didn't have a repeat, right. Did they? As Anderson bowls outside the off stump and Powell lets it go by. End of the over. Not the end of the over as yet. Still to continue. That wasn't repeated in 2016,
It was supposed to be this year as well, but it's a shame really because it was the greatest couple of weeks of my life.
Three slips and a gully. As Anderson bowls wide outside the off stump, this time Powell doesn't chase it. It is the end of the over now with the West Indies set 322. They are 43 without loss. Brathwaite on 19, Powell on 23.
Yeah, it was quite good because there's a huge expat community from India and Pakistan in America. That's what it's appealing to.
There's a huge expat Indian community everywhere.
We were staying in a hotel in Times Square, New York. And the first day, as Sachin Tendulkar walked out with Sourav Ganguly and VVS Laxman and Rahul Chahal, a pandemonium. I mean, cars blocked everywhere. So the NYPD were brought in the next day. There's crowd control. And as they're walking out, all the Indians went first. Sachin Tendulkar went, and it was bedlam. The cameras screaming, the high-pitched Indian screaming. And I was just stood near this NYPD man. Hey, buddy, who is this guy? And I said, oh, it's Sachin Tendulkar. He's like the Michael Jordan of the cricket world. He sort of rolled his eyes and looked the other way.
And I'm really surprised, given the interest, again, from the expatriate Indian community, especially, and the subcontinent generally, in the United States and Canada, that they haven't had a repeat of that series.
I'll leave you in charge. You can be my agent then.
There goes Broad. Starts a new over. Bowls on off stump to Brathwaite. He's pushing into the offside. Will get one. Will they look for the second? They'll get it comfortably after a bit of hesitation, moments hesitation from Brathwaite, who was ball watching for a while before Kieran Powell called him through. He's up to 21. It's 45 without loss. A good start here for the West Indies. At the end of the last over, Anderson having a look in Powell's direction. Maybe a bit of a word, but in the end, nothing too much. He's always grumbling and mumbling about something, is Jimmy Anderson.
He doesn't say a cheerful word till lunchtime, Jimmy. Bless him. Very grumpy. But yeah, they're having a bit of a dig. They'll be getting demerit points here.
Are they going to have to do like you see in football where they're always covering their mouths when they're talking and whatever else it is?
That's in like gangster moves, isn't it? In the Goodfellas and stuff.
Broad bowls to Brathwaite, letting it go by outside the off stump. It remains 45 without loss.
Cover your mouth so the lip readers can't hear you on the corner.
I mean, what are you saying? I mean, okay, that the camera's going to pick up, that it's going to make a difference to a football game. What are you saying?
Well,
let's get this one off. He's playing absolute rubbish.
I don't think we should compare ourselves to football, though, if I'm perfect. If you go to a football game in this country, you would honestly be appalled by the language you hear it there. You can't take a kid to it. It's effing and jeffing like you wouldn't believe from the crowd and the players and everyone. And it's not what you want cricket to be like.
As Broad bowls on the line of off stump and Brathwaite is playing it away out towards a point, there is no run again.
There is a point where it becomes abusive and offensive, and I agree with that. But what I'm saying is, like yelling out in frustration, the odd expletive. That's where, what I said earlier, charity swear jar. So you don't get demerit points. It's not bringing the game to dispute. Everyone can understand it. Even if a kid says, Daddy, what did he say there? Can understand it. You don't do that, son, but that's why he did it. If £1,000 per profanity were to go into a charity swear jar, and for something really bad, that's your entire match fee. Honestly, people would stop it.
Here goes Broad. Bowls again on off stumper to Brathwaite, and he's pushing it away for a single out to the left of mid-off. He goes on to 22. Powell is 23, having a few words with Anderson. 46 without loss.
And the reason they'd stop it is because you lose your full match fee three or four times.
There's Broad. Outside the off stump to the left-hander. Just seemed to come off the face of the bat. Or was it just bouncing through a second bounce to Jonny Bairstow? Scoring means at 46 without loss. One delivery left in the over. And the West Indies have done well. They've had a generous slice of luck already. Brathwaite put down. How much was he on, Andrew, when he was missed? He was on four at slip by Alastair Cook, the normally very safe pair of hands of Alastair Cook. Seemed to just misjudge it completely. Just got the ends of the fingers.
Just flicked the end of his finger. It went quickly, though. Day five, you don't expect them to come as quickly as that high to his left.
Broad, last ball of the over, and edged and taken this time. Taken at fourth slip, high into the chest. And this time, no luck for Kieran Powell, who departs for 43. England have gotten the breakthrough. courtesy of Stuart Broad. The West Indies are 46 for one.
Brilliant from Stuart Broad, persevering with a full length, just going across power, went for that drive. Very vulnerable outside the off stump. Ben Stokes makes absolutely no mistake. And Stuart Broad's put his hands over his mouth, shaking his head. I think Kieran Powell just started having a few words with the England players. He incensed Jimmy Anderson. You don't want to get out three balls later.
And we're going to say farewell to Swanies. And I'm also going to depart. And we're going to be joined by Daniel Norcross, who will take over the action with the West Indies, just having lost their first wicket.
Thank you, Fazir. Well, that was a wicket that was very timely for England. West Indies have batted very well this morning, 46 for one. It's a long, long way to go. It's a long, long day. But the early runes looked pretty good. As the clouds are beginning to lift, the forecast is an improving one. So to get through that first 45 minutes, we had that curious delay. There will have been a reason for it. It was a bit damp on the outfield. Andrew, you've got some information for me.
Quite a decent opening partnership, as we were talking about. The West Indies have had a real problem with opening partnerships in the last 3 years. Since the beginning of 2015, they've had 44 opening partnerships. And I've had a total of 803 runs in those opening partnerships, averaging just 18.25 with only 150 partnership in nearly 3 years.
Just 150 partnership, and again, not quite making it to 50, 46 when this first wicket fell. Geoffrey, what have you made of the morning's play so far?
Excellent bowling by Stuart Broad and Jimmy Anderson. Jimmy Anderson's bowled brilliantly all match. Just look, sometimes the ball is so good, they don't nick it. Stuart Broad's had two nicks. It's actually the best line and length he's bowled, because he's pitched it up and he's got it right away, where the other day he never got it. He just couldn't get the line. Even last night, he never made him play.
Anderson starts a new over and Brathwaite pushes back on a square on the offside. The thing about a single, it's not there. Kyle Hope, it was, had come halfway down the wicket. It wasn't really a single there. And there was a moment of concern.
And as I say to bowlers, sometimes just not there, the rhythm isn't there, and that's why captains have to suss that quickly. Like last night, watching Stuart Broad bowl it wide, after 2 hours overs, I'd have said, thank you very much. Whoa, hang on, Moeen come and bowl earlier. Just not there.
Anderson in again, Brathwaite covers up in defence. Firm, good, solid defence, back to the bowler, there's no run.
And then you get other days, they just find it immediately. Just the way it is, as human beings, and rather than just automatically saying, hey, these are our best two bowlers, we'll give them five or six overs each. When he gets...
when he's not in rhythm, then you can see it.
And Joe Root, as he gets along with him, he'll go, hey, Brian Closius to Fred Truman, say, hey, thank you, Fred. Fred, well, I've only had two overs, you know. No, thank you. You know, let's bring you back.
Three slips, gully and a backward point as Anderson is in. Has it been taken?
Well,
I don't know. If it's, well, actually, we're not sure here. He's come forward to take that catch as Westley, I believe.
But I don't
think he's certain. And if he's not certain, then I think it's highly unlikely this will be out. We'll wait to see what the umpires give us, a soft signal. They're now going to review this. It was a thick edge down to third slip.
He should be able to see that. He's got as clear a view as anything, the umpire standing at the bowler's end.
He should be able to see it, shouldn't he? Now we wait.
Oh, yes.
Now let's wait for the soft signal. So they're going to go upstairs, and the soft signal is not out.
Mark.
Now, we've seen what happens when soft signals are not out.
Legality of the catch. Can we start
earlier
the front
this week?
Please?
Now then, here we go. It's as with always with Jimmy Anderson.
Your best shot.
Fair delivery. So this is all about whether this ball is carried. Here it comes. Played quite soft hands. Pushing forward, and that's bounced. So that is not going to be out.
You can see it clearly bounced. It just looked as if he was going to scoop it. I can't explain it any other way. Bounced. It's a feeling you get when you've played a lot. It wasn't as if he was catching it low. As if he was catching it on the bounce.
His body movement was going.
It looked like that.
Yeah.
We should have known that bounce. Sorry, I'm sorry. Look, we've played a long time, some of us. You know when you've mostly caught it on the bounce.
Is it good, please?
And it was a clear bounce, I'd say.
A clear bounce, you're right. Good word.
It's clear. They are still looking.
What are you looking at there?
I don't think he's caught that, has he? No, you can see the grass actually move.
There's no way he's caught it.
I don't know why we're taking so long, see, Jeffrey.
Get on with it.
Well, it's...
He should know he's got that on the half volley. Sorry, he should know that.
Well, we're going to get confirmation of the not out, finally. That took a bit longer than I thought, because it looked clearly not out in the first replay. Anyway, Anderson starts in again to Brathwaite, and he covers up in defence this time, pushes out to Broad, and a wide mid off, who then juggles it with his foot. I never like it when they do that. The ball's precious, but...
These two West Indian batsmen, whoever's in, they've just got to see the hard new ball off. Once the ball gets a bit soft, you'll find it'll get easier. Like it did when two of them were getting 100. Once you get into the middle of the afternoon, after lunch, it gets softer, the ball. The afternoons are usually for batsmen, mornings for bowlers here.
Here is Anderson again. Three slips and a gully. Brathwaite waits for him and lets the ball go outside the off stump, through to the keeper. Bairstow, is it right? It feels right that the morning sessions yielded the most wickets in this test match. There were four from memory on the first day, a couple on the second. The morning, it always feels right here, Eddie. This morning it felt bowling morning, didn't it, when we arrived and it was damp and overcast. And
absolutely.
It was one of those sort of early 90s Headingley days.
It'll be lovely for batting this afternoon. The ball gets softer.
And then I suppose we'll expect to see a lot more of Moeen as Anderson is in again. Brathwaite drives off the back foot nicely through extra cover. It's going to be pursued by a combination of Stoneman and Broad. Stoneman beats Broad to the chase, but can he get to the ball? He does. He scoops it back. And in tandem, Broad now flings the ball back to Bairstow. But not before the batsmen have completed three runs, 49 for one. Now, Stephen Davis has been in touch on email. He says, am I the only person who thinks England should have batted on this morning on the fifth day of this test match? I do not think they have enough runs. Why am I worrying so much about this? Just have a feeling England have done the wrong thing. Jeffrey, I haven't had a chance to talk to you about the declaration.
Ask Steve Davis what his job is. Can you? Because whatever it is, Steve, I should stick to it.
So you thought it was an excellent declaration, yeah?
I think you have to declare and try and win. I mean that with a bit of humour, but you have to try and win.
Yeah.
Look, you can't just sit on and say, oh, we were losing this test, we've now got out of jail, I'll play and make sure. Best captains try to win. And if they're good enough to get those runs, put your hand up and say, hey, don't blame Joe Root, don't blame the England, say, well played, West Indies, you deserve it.
That's exactly what Graham Swan said.
Did he?
He said exactly that. He was delighted with the declaration. Michael Vaughan was delighted with the declaration. Simon was a bit more equivocal about
it. I wasn't bothered if he batted till the close of play.
Right.
Got another 20.
Yeah.
You know, because I felt throughout today trying to get 20 wickets, I know how this can go very nice batting when you get a soft ball. Later on today, if they don't keep getting wickets, it'll go soft the ball. It'll be nice for batting. We've seen periods here when batsmen have got in, like England did yesterday, when the two Centurions got in for West Indies. It looked pretty easy then, didn't it?
So the sun came out, it looked very comfortable.
You get
indeed
moments at Headingley where the seamers fancy the chances, and then you get moments when you think, is this the same pitch? Batsmen are creaming it round the park. But I just think it's better to try to win.
And also, Geoffrey, by dangling the carrot, the West Indies are still going to say to themselves, we can win the series if we win the next two test matches. So they've got to be looking at this as a target. They're not going to come out to play for the draw, are they? Because they've been set 318. If they've been set 360, they might have thought it's not there for us.
I hope they've said this morning, we're going to play sensible this morning. This is going to be the most difficult period with the new ball, because it's hard. You've seen some great deliveries move around. You easily nick them. But just play. If you get something easy to hit, take it. But don't go silly. You'll be able to score quicker as the ball gets softer later on. You don't want to be four down this morning. You're not going to get 300 nod.
Well, then, yes, and the game's up, isn't it?
Yeah, you don't want to be four down at lunch. You just want to play sensibly. We lose one, maybe two, we're in the game.
Remember, by the way, there's lots of county cricket on today. You can listen to every ball of every game on the cricket section of the BBC Sport website. Currently, Somerset are closing in on Essex. 156 for 8 they are, replying to the leaders Essex all-out 159. It's a really tight game in prospect there. No batting points as yet. And don't forget, you can watch highlights of this game, and it's looking like it could yet be a humdinger on the BBC Sport website and on the app.
49 for one as we resume after drinks break. If you're wondering why we were chatting, four slips in as Broad comes into Brathwaite, who works his ball nicely through a wide mid-on. He's going to pick up at least two. It's being pursued, and it will be hauled back in. So just the two, but the 50 is up with that, 51 for one. And just a reminder as well, because this could yet be a humdinger, Geoffrey.
Yep.
The today, tickets, £10 for adults, £5 for senior citizens and students, and free for kids. Free, as Graham Swan said earlier. Bring your kids down. He said it was free babysitting, but broadly speaking...
I hope if West Indies play brilliantly and get these runs, which I think is... It's not as easy, but if they do, I hope people don't criticise England and Joe Roop. I hope they say, more well done West Indies, great game of cricket.
Broad in again, that's a full ball, it's attacking the stumps, and this is what didn't do yesterday, defended back at the wicket, no run yesterday. The 30 balls bowled by Anderson and Broad, none of them were shown would have hit the stumps. Today, it feels to you like they're attacking those stumps a bit more? Look like it.
Yeah, Stuart has. Stuart's got better rhythm. Yeah, I mean, he could have had another wicket, couldn't he?
Well, he could.
Yeah, it wasn't an easy catch. It seemed to go quick on him and swing a little. I think that's what deceived him a bit. Cookie at slip.
Here's Broad once more. He's got a shortish mid-wicket in, outside the off stump, left alone in the channel, coming through at good pace. That 86 miles an hour, Geoffrey.
That's his best pace. And whatever you do, you're not going to catch everything at slip. I think a lot of people who saw him, Bobby Simpson, regarded him as one of the greatest ever slippers. I know I asked him one day when I got to know him, and he said, listen, you catch 8 out of 10, you're brilliant.
Right.
I said, really? And I'm like looking at him thinking everything I've ever seen him get is caught. You know, I haven't seen him drop one. And he said, no, 8 out of 10, brilliant.
I had some fine slippers, Australia. Mark Waugh, bring another. Next ball. Oh, leaps a bit off the pitch. Well played by Brathwaite. He's watching it well. He's really impressed us this game, I'd say. Brathwaite batted well first innings.
A lot of those you're going to talk about, Mark Waugh and people of that era who caught really well, Taylor, captain at slip, they worked as young kids under Bobby Simpson, and they said his training sessions were brilliant.
Yeah.
About fielding were absolutely brilliant. We really understood about catching.
Phil Sharp would have been a great good slipper.
We've called him Toby Jug, was his nickname, because he stood at slip. You remember those Toby Jugs? So still he was, absolutely still. Catching, just on his haunches a little. No, he's a great slipper. And he had tiny hands.
Really?
Not about big hands, tiny hands, in Philip.
Broad's in again to Brathwaite. Four slips in and another ball that's attacking those stumps, I like to see, pushed up to mid-off.
I actually think he should have played more for England. You know, I never had any say. I was a young kid when he was playing, but I think he'd have done... He was a good pitch player. Played at Works Up School, I think. And when you get abroad, you don't get so much lateral movement. You get bounce, pace, and he's a very good player of that, and he's just a brilliant slipper.
Especially in Australia, I can imagine.
All those places abroad, I think he... You know, they'd have been wiser to have picked him more abroad.
Broad to Brathwaite, and that's just on off stump. Pushed it to the offside by Brathwaite. They scamper through for a single. He moves to 28, 52 for one. Andrew.
Bobby Simpson took 110 catches in 62 tests. 1.77 the match, which is easily the highest of anyone who took 100 catches.
Is that right?
Yep.
What's Cook's average? It's been marked, 151 in...
Yeah, and 146 is just over one.
Right, 1.77.
I can't remember in the number of tests I played, Simpson, I can't remember him dropping one. That's the thing. Like I said about Alan Knott's wicket-keeping. That's why, for me, he was the best I ever saw or played with.
You can't think of him dropping?
I can remember one stumping only.
Yeah.
And we all sort of were mesmerised. There was silence.
Yeah.
It went between bat and pad and off-spinner off Raymond Dillingworth. In the last test in Sydney of 71, and we were like,
gobsmacked, because you'd never seen
it. Silence, we'd never seen it.
Now then, Moeen Ali's into the attack from the football stand end. He bowled his one over yesterday from Kirkstall Lane end, but this was the end that Roston Chase bowled at, the off spinner for the West Indies. You think this is the right end? Do you think it'd make any difference, really, which end he's going to bowl from?
I think if England are going to win, they'll all have to swap around a bit and muck about. There'll be somewhere somebody will get in and you've got to change ends and over the wicket, round the wicket, keep creating problems. That's what you have to do. I don't think... I'll be surprised if people keep getting out like that somewhere. Yeah. Somebody will
You're
get
expecting
in.
Toil today.
Yeah, hard I'm work. Expecting them to work. I don't think it'll be so straightforward. I mean, I'll be surprised if it is.
Slip and a leg slip in. Short extra, mid off. Man on the point boundary, a short mid-wicket, a deeper mid-wicket, wider one. Forward comes Brathwaite and he turns this round the corner. He's going to pick up a single for it, but no more than that.
These pitches at Headingley, these straw-coloured things, where it's in, they don't normally stop you from scoring. That's why I said last night, no problem Joe Root declaring, but I wouldn't have been unhappy if he'd got another 20-odd runs. Because he wants to set attacking field, he wants to try to win. But they've scored all right this morning, haven't they, with attacking fields? It's usually...
They have. Mm. And, of course, if the West Indies do get away, he can always go more defensive, can Root. He's now, he's got a... Carl Hope in his sights, got a forward short leg, and the leg slip and the slip in. Moeen bowls to Hope, beats him on the outside edge as he goes very uncertainly back into his crease. Andrew, Carl Hope, the three innings he's had so far, how many runs has he accrued? Doesn't feel like many to me, as Moeen Ali's into him again. And he goes back into his crease, but defends it nicely. Good firm push into the covers, fielded by Stuart Broad, no run.
40 runs in total.
Here's Moeen again. He's coming in off that very short run, four or five steps. He's in. Oh, that's a full ball, which is dug out by Kyle Hope. And no more than that. Forward short leg picks up. There's only the one man out in the boundary, a deep backward square leg. Mid-on's up, not that far up. As Moeen is in to Hope again, and he goes again back into his crease and shuffles across his stumps, pushes back up the wicket, no run, one ball left in this over from Moeen. And it's as if people have decided they're all going to play Moeen Ali this summer by moving across to off stump.
And they're all staying back.
Yeah.
They're not looking to play forward.
Moeen's in again now. He's forward to that one. He's a little bit fuller, and he pushes out to the offside. Stuart Broad does the fielding. That completes... An over from Moeen Ali that conceded just the one or two runs. One run, just the one run from it. 53 for one. Brathwaite has 29. Kyle Hope has yet to score. And with more thoughts, it will be Geoffrey Boycott and then Jonathan Agnew.
It's not a bad way to play. At Headingley, I talked before about it's not a quick pitch for spinners, and that's why they haven't been successful at Headingley, even when it's turned. So if you stay back and you've got a little extra time to play, even when it turns, you've got time to watch it and play with it. I'm not saying you shouldn't play forward at all, get right forward, but don't look to, used to be an old saying, if in doubt, push out, and I don't believe in that with spinners.
Afternoon, Geoffrey.
Hello.
Looking very smart in your baby pink. 53 for one, Broad. Bowled all morning from this end. Runs in now. Bowls very full.
Oh, it's hard back.
Oh, has it run out? I think it's a run out at this end.
Doubt.
I think Hope's going to be run out. It was hit hard, very back at Broad. It might have been a catch. Yep. The ball burst through his hands. And Hope was backing up, as he might well be, at the non-striker's end. And by a sheer fluke, England have taken their second wicket. I'd like to see a replay of the catch at Broad in the first post. It was hit very firmly back at him.
I think
couldn't
it
see
was.
It from that angle, but it came off his body straight into the stumps, and that's going to be the end of Hope, who had no chance there. He was his bat was in the air. He was a yard out of his ground, but I wouldn't mind seeing the chance of the catch again.
You don't think
Broad.
It was a catch? I do.
I think it was, but I would like to see it. Just to be clear.
I think he got his hands to it, but couldn't hold it because it was a hot potato. It was driven. With a very full ball,
yeah.
It was driven sort of waist-high hard, and he had no chance to catch it, as you know, following through. And he tried to get his hands there, and it just went through his hands and straight onto the stumps. And the lad, unfortunately, that really is unlucky. I mean, he was backing up the right way. He was yard and a half out, wasn't he, or something. He had no chance.
That's a horrible way of getting out, that, actually. Yeah. Well, all jesting aside. Have that ever happened to you? Sometime in the dim and distant, it must have done, I guess, if you played enough cricket. But it's well, everyone feels bad. Well, right. The batting side. I mean, the batsman himself feels bad. The fellow who's lost his wicket.
You used the right word. That's a fluke.
Yeah.
That's a real. You couldn't make that up.
No. Well, England aren't complaining. Shai Hope now replaces his rather disgruntled brother. And out he comes. And as I was saying, if West Indies has got through to lunch only one down or so, then they'll have had a very good morning. But they've lost their second wicket, albeit through very unfortunate circumstances. And once again, they've got that little tightening, that focus of what they've got to try and do here. And that's they've got 76 overs to bat still.
They've got to get through 45 minutes after lunch.
Here it was a catch, but it's technically a catch. Hit very hard back at Broad. And it hit his hands, it hit his body, and then ricocheted somehow straight into the stumps. So all round bad luck for the non-striker, but a real bonus for England. It's been that sort of match in a way. Strange things, catches being dropped, and I mean very easy catches being dropped.
A lot of catches. Yes. Both sides.
Oh, and you see something like that. So Brathwaite stood on strike. He'll feel a bit miserable, I'd imagine. As Broad runs in, bowls to him on 29, and there's an edge, and it's four. Down through third man, he squared him right up. And this is Brathwaite's job now. Somehow he's got to clear his mind of that. The fact that it's Kyle Hope's brother who's at the other end might be a little bit more difficult for him to think about something else. But he's got to clear his mind of what happened there and just get on with what he was doing pretty well. He did give a chance earlier himself. But all these catches going down. And then a bizarre dismissal. Sun's trying to break through now as Broad hitches up the short sleeve of his right arm and sets off again. Brathwaite, bat raised, waits for Broad. It's edged again. And again it's going to be four, I think, although a lot of the pace has taken off by the slip fields, but it has got into the boundary. And Broad looks furious now. He's going to combust at any moment because, again, he's squared Brathwaite right up. Found a very healthy edge. It just moved ever so slightly off the seam. Bounced in front of the slip fielder, and I think it was Westley. Hit him on the leg.
Can't blame fielders for that.
No, you can't.
Once it bounces like that, you're getting ready for the catch. You're looking at the bat, and then it bounces just a couple of feet, 2.5 feet, and you can break a finger, can't you, when it's going that quick?
Straight up your nose.
Yeah.
Right, they've got a third man now.
He's just got to keep his cool. He's bowling well.
Yeah. Brathwaite on 37. Broad's on his way and he bowls to him on middle and leg and turns him round and plays out towards mid-wicket. Interesting that they've got a third man, though, because in context of the game, West Indies are sort of a long, long way behind, and that's obviously a very defensive run-saving position. They've still got four slips, mind you, so a point mid-off. Well, they've got, actually, looking round, they've got a third man
away.
And no fine leg, yeah. And that's OK, actually. I would like to have lost an attacking man for the sake of a third man, would you?
I don't think you need a third man. Look, they're two down, 61 for two. Absolutely. They're a long way away yet.
Yep, it is.
Oh, his bat's broken.
Brathwaite's broken his bat. So,
I mean, you know, you just want wickets while it's new ball.
Yep.
Middle of the afternoon can be a bit different, see where you are then, but with this new ball zipping around, you could nip a couple more out just like that.
What used to happen, of course, is you'd borrow your partner's bat, wouldn't you, until the end of the over, and then you'd have one brought out, but not anymore. It's another opportunity for more time to go. And so we're waiting for somebody down there to locate Brathwaite's spare bats and bring him a couple out. But not normally, you'd use your mate at the other end.
Well, you would, the way you bat, but we want our own bat that we feel good about.
Would you, if you'd broken your bat mid-over, you'd have got another one out, would you?
Yeah,
would
definitely.
You? Okay, fair enough.
They do break more now because they're brittle, we've said, but
yeah.
I'd have two or three in a season, that's all. Now they've got loads, haven't they, because they break. But, I mean, two normally a season. I'd have a third ready if I needed it, but I definitely used two, that was all.
I think he's running a couple out. He's appeared now, the 12th man, and taking one out. So today, Powell's out for 23, caught by Stokes off Broad. And then Hope, that rather unlucky waves, run out backing up as Broad dropped a catch. He dropped Brathwaite. So he better buy Carl Hope a drink tonight because he should have been out. But in fact, it turned out that Hope was out because the ricochet from the drop catch went into the stumps. So all ways round, that's pretty unfortunate. Mm. 61 for two. Brathwaite's got his new bat. Let's see how he gets on with it. He's certainly breaking in the edge of the other one. And Broad, over the wicket, runs in and bowls to him, and he plays that away down to backward point, moving across the crease, not getting onto the front foot, and it's fielded at backward point. Down there on the west stand, there are people being corralled into just a couple of sections of that stand. There are some empty ones. Mm. So it goes empty, full, empty, full. So lots of upturned blue plastic seats. But
There's a
good crowd in for the fifth day. I think Yorkshire got the marketing absolutely right, Geoffrey, I must say. Attracting people to come down. They'd have their eye, I'm sure, on the Ashes 2019. They want to get people in. Give them a taste of Test cricket.
Kids free, I like.
Yeah. Then comes Broad, bowls. Brathwaite plays across his pad. A great howl there from behind the stumps because he played across the line down to mid-on. And Broad gets the applause for the wicket and for a good over. A couple of edges found. Although that's a bit of a burgle as far as that wicket was concerned. 61
I wasn't
for two.
On with you when Stuart was bowling, you know, wide and everything. I wanted to ask you, as a bowler, you had moments when you couldn't get your rhythm and you bowl wide because you swung it out. So you got moments when you just set it off too wide and it was useless, if I might say, you know, not making them play.
Very often, Geoffrey.
No, he didn't. But, I mean, what did you think yourself, you know?
Well, what would happen is you just end up bowling a little bit too straight and it wouldn't swing and
clip you through leg side.
It's funny, even when you're very experienced, you know, when you come out and bowl for five or six overs at the end of a day, you can get a bit carried away.
You're expected to get wickets.
Mm. You're running in, you're full of adrenaline, you're excited. And
your mates are cheering, you're on
absolutely.
The ball quicker.
You've got
and
very
this.
Attacking fields and the whole thing can just run away with you a little bit. But I'm just worried a bit about Stuart Broad's outswing. I think he's all this round the wicket to the left-hander, he's pushing the ball away, but he doesn't seem to get that ball swinging away from the right-hander very much now.
That's the wicket-taking ball.
It is. Moeen from the far end then comes in and he tosses that right up. It's a low full toss. She's hit hard down to mid-off. Where he finds Joe Root. I like the speed of that, but didn't quite get the length. So there's a slip, a short leg, and then a man on the drive on either side at cover. And also mid-wicket, as Moeen grips the ball, pauses for a moment, parts his hands, and comes in again over the wicket. Oh, almost creeps through, with Hope there on the back foot. Try and get forward, I think, if he can here, but he certainly that hurried him a bit. Almost crept through. 61 for two. That's his second ball, crouching over his bat now. Moeen, under very cloudy skies, bowled outside the off stump. That turns sharply, pops up, hits the pad. And Stokes wanders round from slip to field, and I think he's pointing there to Root. So, do you fancy another one in here? Really bounced, didn't it?
Yeah, there'll be enough there to interest him. I think he's going to mix up his pace.
Moeen, over the wicket, bowls, has clipped away along the ground, straight to mid-on this time. Woakes Fields, 61 for two, bright in the distance, quite dark overhead at the moment. They've got a few bulbs on, but not enough to make much of an impact, I wouldn't have thought, as Moeen again bowls. Oh, that's gone scuttling through, and again he's on the back foot. Oh, that's so nearly bowled him.
See, I understand he wants to stay back, not get dragged forward when he shouldn't be, but...
Oh, well, I think it might have been a drop.
He's staying back to everything, which is not a good idea. Stay back and get right forward. And he's staying back to balls there that he should be playing forward to.
Well, I see that replay again. I just wonder if that was a difficult chance to Jonny Bairstow, actually. 61 for two. They've got their backs to us, so it's hard to see live. And he's forward now, pushing away out to point. And there's no run. It's the end of the over. 61 for two. Moeen on target and Hope finding it pretty tricky out there. He's marking his guard again. They've shown the replay on the big screen. Too late for me to see it, but nothing on ours. I think that might have been a little drop catch, actually.
Difficult one, because it kept low, didn't it? That's why the batsman had a problem with it.
Good game in Dhaka, by the way. Australia need 156 more runs to beat Bangladesh. Mm. They're 109 for two. No, it was off the pad.
Mm. It was off difficult to take or catch, because it kept low, and that's why the batsman had a problem. He's kept wicket well last couple of tests and more. This year, in fact, he's done really good.
Good game that, isn't it? 109 for two, so 156 more. Warner 75, Smith 25.
They've got their two good players in. That's what Bangladesh have got. It's like having Cook and Root in India and our lot. You know, you've got to get them out. It's like we will this winter. England will have to get Warner and Smith out. The rest are not in the same category.
Now, Stuart Broad has bowled, what time is that? It's about seven or eight overs so far.
This is his eighth of the morning.
61 for two. He's bowling to Brathwaite again. Still with the third man. In goes Broad. Bowls outside the off stump. He thumps that to mid-off. It was. That was a very, very attacking shot indeed. Hit in the air a bit. Woakes is the fielder.
Well, he stays back to everything.
Yep.
And that makes you bowlers, you know, think, well, I've got to pitch it up a bit more than I want, and then you get it a little bit, and then he really flays at it, doesn't he? Then
yep.
He really gets stuck into a long half volley.
61 for two. Brathwaite's on 37. So lots of time for England to bowl. West Indies out here. They need a 261 more to win. Broad runs in. Bowls a beauty. Now, that did move away. Lovely delivery from Broad. Just the right length of Brathwaite, who's hanging around inside that crease again. Just went enough, and there was a bounce there too, but it's moved off the seam.
Can't bowl better balls than that, Jonathan, can you? Not without getting a nick. I mean, they're absolute beauties.
Yeah.
You just got to show patience on here. The guys that can keep the cool when the people are playing and missing and not getting the nick, just keep the cool and keep bowling it there. You'll get wickets eventually.
Yeah. Sun out. Broad composes himself and now sets off once again from a slight angle. Bowls and Brathwaite drives him down the ground. That'll come for four. Not out of the middle of the bat by any means. A slightly closed face. But Brathwaite here seems to be going on the attack. He's getting some outstanding balls from Broad. Whether he's beginning to think that one of them's got his name on it, I don't know. But clubbing off drive earlier, now a slightly closed face straight drive. Four more, 65 for two, 257 more for West Indies to win. And England want these eight wickets. It's Broad again. It waits for a moment. Breeze ruffling at the back of his shirt. Down go the slips. He's on his way past the umpire. There now, bowls to Brathwaite outside the off stump. That one he lets go by. 65 for two. Vaughan is pursing his lips. It's good cricket.
Taz, it's done a bit, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Expect that in these conditions on the last day. I have to say, Kraigg Brathwaite looks a real fighter. Understands his game, doesn't he? He just hangs back, and England have tried a bowl fuller to him. You can see that. I mean, Broad's got a few half volleys to him, but he's kind of leant back into them, played some nice on drives, played a good off drive as well. Had a little bit of fortune, didn't he, with that drop catch of Alastair Cook. You don't see that often from the ex-England captain.
65 for two. Broad on his way. Brathwaite has his bat raised and is on the back foot, pushing away out to Woakes' left. In fact, just defeats Woakes there a little. And so they can come back for two runs for that push through cover. 67 for two. Brathwaite moves to 43. Yes, it was a very catchable catch, that one. Just to add to the list of...
It swung a little bit on him. It just swung away from him. And also, it hit him hard. It just went through him before he got his hands in the right place. I tell you, looking back to yesterday, I guess they're England side are lucky that Moeen Ali played the way they did, because this pitch is playing all right. We've seen some lovely shots.
Yep.
67 for two.
It's a really good pitch, because there's a little bit there for the bowlers, and the seam bowler's still on the last day too. In goes Broad, and he bowls. Oh, comes cutting back, and Brathwaite's hit on the pad there. All trickles away in the offside. It's the end of the over. Another good one from Broad. On how long route will keep him going for. 67 for two. We've got 25 minutes to go until lunch. We're assembling our journalist panel for lunch break. Lots of things to talk about. I see you were moved to have a comment about Jason Holder's demerit point this morning, Michael.
It's madness, isn't it?
Well, I must admit, when you're not... It's that fine line. So somehow they've got to stop swear words coming out of your telly. But when you're not actually having a go at anybody...
I think the commentators do the job, don't they? They just apologise for the language that you've just heard. It happens in all of the sports.
Here's Moeen. That's driven out to cover. Past the man in close. And is trickling out towards deep cover. And they're actually going to... come back for three there. Nice chase from Root, who gets a Yorkshire welcome down there on the West Stand. 70 for two. In fact, I did say, clearly erroneously, because actually I was watching the men's rugby a lot, and there didn't seem to be much swearing in that, but one or two of my Twitterers have said, too, should listen to the women's. In fact, there's a lot on that.
Well, you watch the golf. You watch golf on television now.
Swearing on that.
Yeah, players play a bad shot, they're frustrated. And
That's not necessarily a good thing, though. Somehow they've got to try and stop it.
It's not a good thing, but it's just the nature of being under a bit of pressure or being frustrated that you've just made a mistake.
Well, there's a difference between that and abusing somebody, definitely. Here's Moeen. Bowls, that's turned away to forward.
What happens if you get out, you've played a bad shot, you say nothing, but as you're walking off, you know, you're telling yourself off a few expletives. Is that the same? Or is it because it hasn't been heard on the stump mic?
In comes Moeen, and he bowls, and that's pushed away into the onside. Well, I'd hope, actually, if you're walking off, then you'll be able to compose yourself and get off, and then you can let yourself go a bit. But what happens out there in the heat of battle, that moment where a fast bowler's tearing in, giving everything, desperate for a wicket, and a catch goes down, is Moeen turned away out towards short leg. That's, I think, where you could expect the frustration. I think by the time you're walking off, you shouldn't be.
But it happens,
so
you see it all the time. It doesn't make it right, though. No, but would you give a demerit point for someone that's...
I think if they are
telling off of themselves.
Obviously, when they're that far off the field, I think that's more of a reason for it. Now, there's an appeal for leg before wicket. And that trickles out to cover. It's a difficult, really difficult area, isn't it? And that you can't openly encourage people to go yelling and screaming out there, coming out of the tellies, because you're not... directing it at anybody. It's got to be policed. Is Moeen, that's turned away out towards mid wicket. But on the others, there is a difference between addressing it to somebody and not. And so somehow they've got to find a way around this.
Well, I like the stump microphone. I think it brings something different to the game. I think I like hearing Jonny Bairstow, you know, having a little bit of a chirp. I used to love not facing him. I used to love Gilchrist in Ball Warney. That's great, but. If the stump microphone is going to get the likes of Ben Stokes banned from an Ashes test match, or Rabada banned, or Jason Holder banned for one game, you know, I'd rather get rid of the stump mic, because I'd rather have the players that, you know, someone like Ben Stokes is a superstar for test match cricket. We need him playing. Obviously, if he's shouting at a batsman and effing and blinding at the umpire, absolutely. You know, he should be done. But if it's just in pure frustration...
Perhaps you need to create your own... words of frustration that you channel yourself to let go when you're angry on the cricket field. Like,
do you think they need another member of the support staff?
Perhaps they do. It's a sort of vocabulary teacher.
Yes.
Where you can release a really angry word, but it's not a swear word.
Yeah, I mean, that's the next thing that comes into cricket. It'll have to come into cricket, because you don't want your lights. So if they're going to carry on just, you know, giving out these points for... you know, swear words coming through the mic. Well, the player's clearly something's going to have to be done.
It's like CMJ, who coached himself not to swear on the microphone by saying fish cakes. if Jason Holder shouted fish cakes yesterday, he's not going to get a demerit point, is he? But he'd have got rid of a bit. Fish cakes, if you let Fotherington Thomas go, you knew you were in trouble. But anyway,
I just think, Agus, there's bigger issues in the game.
Of course there are. You know, of course
I think that's what concerns me, that the over-8s continuously...
But you also want kids to be able to watch a game without a stream of...
My little boy plays, watches, he's never come to me and said, Dad, I get really put off by some of the language. I was thinking in this last two or three years of Test cricket, I've watched Test cricket and thought, I don't see that there's many issues at all.
In goes Woakes, and he's going over the wicket and bowls outside the awesome, but lovely length that. And line, by the way, to Hope, who let that go by, but that's really full, just swinging away a little bit.
And I think the players know that, you know, they're under so much scrutiny, and with all the different cameras now, that I think the behaviour on the pitch is good. I never see. I mean, we saw a bit of Kieran Powell and Jimmy Anderson. You know, I don't think that's bad.
No, it's not.
I didn't see them point. I just thought there was a little bit of a conversation, a bit of chirp. I thought, yeah, that's fine, nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. No, you can't pretend that sort of thing doesn't go on. It's Woakes over the wicket, and he bowls down the leg side. Poor follow-up, that collected by Jonny Bairstow. Now, it's an interesting one for the authorities to work out, because
it's very difficult.
As usual, there's two issues. There's the issues where if you're shouting... However, if it's audible obscenities that are coming
out... Doing it all the time, clearly, there's a problem. But if you're running in, you're charging in down the hill, and you're trying to... get your team back in the contest, which Ben Stokes was trying to do, and all of a sudden an edge flies through the gap, and I go, what are you going to do?
You're going to get frustrated, but you're going to say fish cakes.
Fish cakes.
Yeah, absolutely. In goes Woakes. Bowls, and that's pushed away by Hope off the back foot down to gully. And there's no rugs. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what you say, you're just venting a bit of fury, aren't you?
I think you could be that person. You could join the backroom team.
Vocabulary coach.
Yeah, the fish cake coach.
Fish cakes.
What else could you say? You could shout fish and chips, couldn't you?
I think you could say all sorts of things without being swear words. And they still get it off your chest.
Hello, mate, how are you?
Dash it. And goes Woakes. Bowls down the leg side, brushed away. Backward square leg.
So
no run. I'm hearing him both of them very loudly in my headphones. I hope he doesn't say fish cakes. But we've got a microphone somewhere since we're picking up his telephone conversation.
I think he's probably on the balcony, isn't he? Well, should we listen in to see who he's talking
to? You better warn him. Or at least cut our microphone for a moment. Might spare Sir Ian.
It's about an hour and 15. I think it's 8:40.
Oh, no.
I think he's booking a train.
I think he's planning his return travel. But let's just...
That's a good sign for the West End. It's got to be 8:40. That's tonight.
It is. We'll talk loudly so we can't hear it. 71 for two. Brathwaite's on 43. In goes Woakes. Bowls to him. Down the leg side. Brushes the pad and the bat and runs away from Moeen, who's scuttling round the boundary. And... His throw comes in to Bairstow, a little bit wild. And it's...
I think he's booking a flight there. I don't know what he's off. He'll be going to Spain, won't he? He's
73 off. For two.
Yeah, he's... But as I say, it's a good sign for the West Indies when Sir Ian's thinking about flights and trains at 8:40 tonight, unless it's tomorrow morning and he's staying over tonight. But I think he said 8:40 tonight.
Well, there's part of it. I'd like to have eavesdropped, but I thought possibly it might not be a bit dangerous with millions of people listening. He owes me a pork pie for that, does he, Ian? 73 for two. Brathwaite on 43. In goes Woakes, over the wicket, and bowls on off stump. And Brathwaite moves across into the stumps, plays down to mid-on, and it's the end of the over. So there's about 17 minutes to go until lunch on the final day. And West Indies have lost only two wickets. Brathwaite, 43. Hope has four. They still need 249 to win. And taking us to the break is Simon Mann.
Yeah, he's played... really well. I mean, you think last night the ball was moving around, and again this morning. Well, he's moved to 43, so he's played some wonderful strokes. And the only time he's had an opportunity to score is he's taken that chance. Shai Hope is sticking with that short extra cover. Gone for a leg slip as well. Where's leg slip come from? Oh, short mid wicket now. He's going to move again here. I think he's in the wrong position. Jimmy Anderson, he was at leg slip, maybe saying to the captain, you need a leg slip. He's now moved to short mid-wicket. Just a short leg and a slip around the bat. And Jonny Bairstow, of course, the keeper.
Here's Hope facing Moeen, and Hope plays that firmly up towards deep mid-on, sets off for a single, and he got the other end there so quickly. Got there before the fielder Woakes had got to the ball, and Woakes only had seemingly 3 or 4 yards to make in. Now he goes back to the long-on boundary. He was lurking there halfway back for that one. 74 for two, 322 the target. It's Brathwaite on 43. Moeen bowls and he heaves him into the onside. This is going out towards the boundary. No chance of the fielder at long on. It's 30 yards to his right-hand side. He's got that out towards cow corner. With a bottom hand guiding it away from the fielder at long on. And Brathwaite goes to 47. And West Indies to 78 for two. And if they can... get after Moeen and disrupt him, then that will be a big bonus for West Indies on this final day, because you expect Moeen to have a big impact. Inevitably, the spinner's going to be hit a little bit. Here is Moeen bowling, and forward goes Brathwaite. That's a good delivery, playing that into the hands sharply of the short leg fielder. Went quickly,
yeah,
down.
I think Jimmy Anderson's in the game to Brathwaite. He gets so far over to the offside. You know, to try and nullify the LBW. I just think he might just glance from around the corner to Jimmy at leg slip.
Slip, leg slip, short leg, short mid-wicket, the close catches. And then two men back on the leg side. And here is Moeen into bowl. And Brathwaite comes stabbing forward and gets a thickish outside edge with a slightly open face. And Broad has to run round from cover to his left to pick up. And they're through for a single. Brathwaite to 48.
What's your, rather than the swear word, what are you going to go for? I guess it was fish cake. What are you going to go for?
Gazebo.
Gazebo. Interesting.
It's Moeen bowling. It turned away by Hope down towards deep backwards square leg.
Gazebo. Go on then, give it us. You've just been, you've just running off your long run, and I'm at second, so I've dropped the fourth of that one over. Come on.
Gazebo.
I still think you'll get a point for that.
It has to be something, a word that's all expressive, isn't it? Here is another delivery from Moeen. It's pushed back down the pitch by Brathwaite, slightly in the air. I don't know, there's a bit of bat and pad in that. Manderson came in from mid-wicket to pick up. And there is no run. Well, a fascinating game continues. Weston is 80 for 2. In search of 322. So 242 more runs required for victory. And there are 71 overs left in the day's play. So the runs per over equation is fine. Just a question of whether they can, A, have the skill and the mental strength to keep going and resist England and get up around there. And also whether they have a bit of luck as well. And that run out of Kyle Hope. People say, oh, he should have been back in his crease. I think you are duty-bound as a non-striker to back up. And you know, every now and again in your career, you will be run out backing up. Just, it's one of those things. How many times were you run out backing up?
Maybe once.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it was David Byers. He used to hit it straight. Mm-hmm. So maybe if you're playing with someone who hits it, I was probably a bit dozy getting out of my crease, but someone like Brathwaite, you wouldn't expect him to be hitting it down. He's kind of a nudger and a nerdler, isn't he? Yeah. Square of the wicket. I think if you look throughout the Test match, a lot has gone England's way, you know.
Mm, I agree. Hope on 6. 3 slips in the gully. This is Woakes going into Bolton from the Kirkstall lane. And it's full, struck on the pad. Shout for LBW. Not out, says umpire Ravi. Although sometimes with umpire Ravi's umpiring in this Test match, is a bit like playing bridge. It's like an opening bid. And then someone else comes in with another one.
I'm not that good at bridge. I mean, I don't really know the rules. So what's that? You have an opening bid?
Well, yeah, you I mean, it's a long time since I played it. There'll be people out there who play it regularly, but you have an opening bid, you know, 2 no trumps or something, or 1 heart, and then someone else will...
Well, 2 Donald Trumps.
Trump that, yeah. he's had 4 overturns, is that right, Andrew?
4 overturns, yeah. 2 no trumps is a really strong hand.
Andrew, I bet he's
a good player.
I bet he's a good bridge player. Yeah. 80 for 2. Hope on 6, and Woakes bowls. That's turned away into the onside.
What is the best skill that you need in bridge? What is it? Come on, Andrew, you'll know. You've clearly... What's the main strength? What do I need?
You need to be able to figure out where cards are, or where they're most likely to be. That's pretty
useful. As in the number of the card.
Where the opposition card. So if you're looking for the king of hearts.
Not like that.
So you've got the queen and the ace, and you want to win the trick.
Win the trick, okay.
You want to try and figure out which side the king is of your opponents, because there's 4 of you.
Right. What's win the trick? What's that?
Here is Woakes moving into bowl. It's full. It's defended by Hope back up the offside of the pitch, and there's no run.
4 players. Mm. Each player card and a trick. Okay. And the highest card wins.
Of any suit?
Well, you play a suit, or if you play... If there's trumps, if there's no trumps, then you just play the suit. If there is trumps, then you can trump that trick. If you've got a card in the suit that's the trumps, and you don't have a card in the suit that the trick's being played on.
Ah. It's not one of those card games. Here is Roach bowling that down the leg side, tries to flick it away and misses. It's not one of those card games you could just explain for people.
It's
for
not
2
like
minutes.
Pontoon,
no,
is it?
Just not like, you know, just like snap or something like that. You have to you know, really learn how to play the game. You play with a partner.
Is it pairs?
So you're playing with a partner, and the other lot are playing with a partner as well. 4 people playing. Anyway, you have opening bids, and I feel that sometimes with umpire Ravi, his decisions are, you know, like an opening bid in bridge, and then you start to think about it. Well, can we trump him? This is Woakes bowling outside the off stump, forced away. Beautiful shot from Shai Hope off the back foot drive down the ground for 4. He really hit that well. Wonderful timing, and the ball has stopped on the boundary rope. And Broad is at the mid-off. He's saying, I don't really want to trot back and pick that up. And so someone comes out from down beneath us in a yellow bib and in kit. I presume it's one of the... Is that Mason Crane down there? One of the 12 men who had to come down and pick it up and send it back.
Well, the pitch is pretty good, you know, when you can play a shot like this. This is an incredible shot. You don't see many back foot punches straight down the ground.
Magnificent blow from Hope. Takes him to double figures. He's on 10. 84 for 2. 322 to win. Woakes bowls, and Hope seems to have plenty of time there, going back into stumps and defending back up the offside. And there is no run. End of the over. Moeen's end today. He bowled 1 over from this end last night. It may just be because they wanted Anderson to bowl as many as possible, and he didn't feel Broad was getting it right, so give Moeen a go from this end. But he did turn a couple. He spun it from the other end as well. I don't know whether it's worth changing Moeen's end. Brathwaite, 48 not out after his century in the first innings. And just a reminder that no one has ever made 100 in both innings of a first-class match. The Test match is a first-class match at Headingley, which is an incredible statistic, really, when you think of all the cricket that's
Andrew
been played.
Andrew got very excited, didn't he? Yesterday, all day, at least on the half hour, he kept on mentioning it. Some good alternative swear words coming out here on Twitter. Alan Clayton says fiddlesticks.
Here is Moeen bowling. That's turned away into the onside. Plenty of bottom hand by Brathwaite back down the pitch. Dragging it, trying to get that up to long on, but too straight. Moeen was across, picked up, no run. 8 minutes to go until lunch on this fifth day. And Moeen moves in and bowls to Brathwaite. Gets one down the leg side, and there's an appeal for a stumping there from Bairstow, and they are going to have a look at it. Umpire Ravi just checking this. It didn't feel as if it was out, and there's no real enthusiasm there from the England close catchers. It was down the leg side. He tried to turn away. He just slightly overbalanced. Now we're going to have a look. Umpire Erasmus is the third umpire, if you haven't been with us during the game so far.
Legal delivery. Your best angle, please.
It's a legal delivery. Just having a look at it now.
Thank you. Foot is down. Bell's off.
No, he's all right.
He's okay. But he did slightly overbalance. It was a good piece of work from Bairstow.
Okay, I've opened this now as well. Can you just take it back until where Johnny collects the ball, please?
So just going to have another look, just to make sure. Right, ball in the gloves.
And keep going forward. Thank you. My decision is not out.
There we go. Part of his foot, Ray, he has the overbalance. Part of his foot came out, but he still had his toe inside the crease. So Brathwaite survives. He's 48 not out. Moeen bowls. That's down the leg side again. Something very similar happens. Bairstow, quick as a flash, has the bails off.
Yeah, good stumping there. Because Brathwaite goes so far over to that offside, I do think that little flick down the leg side of Anderson, leg slip, could be his mode of dismissal.
He fell over again there, but one of his feet was back in the
sugar lumps
the whole time.
For crying out loud. There's plenty coming out here on Twitter.
84 for two. Well, they are going to have a look at it in November. Moeen bowls. That's outside the off stump. Guided away. Close to Broad at cover. But they still pinch a single. It wasn't far away from Broad. Good running. 85 for two. Now, West Indies quietly have had a reasonable morning here. They're still in this game. Chance of saving it or winning it.
Someone makes a good point here.
Hope on 10. Moeen bowls. Hope comes forward, turns this with plenty of bottom hand to Jimmy Anderson at mid-wicket, and there is no run.
What happens if you get injured? Bowler runs in, does his hammy or his calf and swears. And it serves for the stump mark. Is that a point as well?
Moeen bowls. Forward goes Hope again. Back down the pitch. There's no run. It's the end of the over. Well, I suppose it's picked up on the stump, Mike. That's it. It doesn't matter what's happened out there. But
you're going to be missing games anyway. You're injured.
Yeah. 85 for two. Well, there's an ICC meeting in November at which the issue is going to be discussed at a big board meeting. I think that's their next big board meeting. Whether there'll be a slight
tinkering.
I just
think some signs with you know, when you say, oh, it's November, they should be able to have a panel that can react quicker. You should be able to have conference calls. You can actually have a meeting now with five or six in different parts of the world. Just have a conference. Surely what we're seeing here this week is it's not good for the game, and it's not great for the game when you're hearing swear words, I have to say, but it happens. It's been happening for many, many years. It's in frustration, not at the players or the umpires. Surely they should be able to act quicker than November.
This is Woakes bowling to Brathwaite, and Brathwaite gets one that seems to bounce a bit, and he plays it well, defending it into the onside, dropping it onto the surface, and stops. Fielder rushes in Malan from square leg to pick up, and there is no run.
Gherkins. It's not a bad one, is it? It's not far off your gazebo. Gherkins.
Just something that, you know, an expressive word. But when that happens, that whatever happens, the torn hamstring or the drop catch, you just revert back, don't he? That's the problem. Here's Woakes bowling, plays across his front pad there, Brathwaite, hence the cries. You hear now affects the microphone from behind the stumps.
This one, sugar butties.
What's your word? Have you said your word?
No, I'm not changing.
All right. Okay. Old-fashioned.
I'm like, yeah, that's what you just said. I think I'd just revert back. Yeah. I just don't think I'd be able to help myself.
It's funny.
I think I'd have to go for a lot of counselling.
Yeah. It's funny that in language in general that we have words that are deemed unacceptable, though. Just a configuration of letters, aren't they?
Do you think we should just be allowed to swear and...
Broke's bowls has played defensively back up the onside of the pitch by Brathwaite, and there's no run. If you go back, I don't know, if you go back 500 years, the words that were probably considered to be swear words were probably completely different, weren't they? Mm. And things that weren't acceptable then are acceptable now, and probably vice versa.
So they're just words, Junior. You should be able to say them whenever you want.
It's funny that people are offended by a configuration of letters. That's all. That's my
sticks
point.
And stones and all that.
Oh. They are just words. 85 for two. Woakes bowls short. Ducks underneath it.
You should be on the ICC committee. You just won't. Oh, they're only words.
Yeah. But they're only offensive because people take offence to them, aren't they?
Oh, yeah, but it's because they're offensive words.
Well, but who decides they're offensive words? Well, who's decided
correct.
That?
Correct. Who is this person that says that?
Do you think in the ICC they've got a list of words as well? It won't be that long,
well,
admittedly.
I think there's some that
like
you get
three on there.
Points for, and there's probably some that you get... Maybe you can make more points for certain words.
Yeah. 85 for two. Yeah. 2 minutes to go until lunch, and there are two balls left in the over, so we might have one more. Woakes... moving in, and bowls, it's full, it's clipped away. He's targeting that pad of Brathwaite, and Brathwaite is playing across his front pad. That was hitting middle stump, but he got plenty of bat on it. Nicely played. In fact, it's a nice-looking shot, but if he didn't, then that was a big problem for him. Brathwaite on 49. Probably not that bothered about getting his 50 before lunch. He's done very well. The reason we're talking about yesterday, of course, about the 200s, because Stokes was batting so well. Andrew was trying to get, or beginning to get excited, and then Stokes just hit one to long off. Here is Woakes bowling to Brathwaite, and Brathwaite gets a ball that swings away, and he pulls the bat out of the line a bit. That's a good over from Woakes, 85 for two, and I think we will have time for one more. Yeah, well, 85 for two. We are going to have time for one more over. Our clock in our commentary box says 1 minute to one. The Dickie Bird clock, and Dickie's here today. It's a bit colder than he was yesterday. It's all wrapped up. The Dickie Bird clock gives England plenty of leeway for another over. 85 for two. West Indies starting at 5 for no wickets. So 80 runs in 22 overs this morning. Remember, we started late at 11:15. Tee is at 3:55 today. Moeen in outside the off stump, and it's defended by Hope rather suspiciously. He's worried about that ball spinning viciously in from outside the off stump and going through the gate. You need to get that pad outside the line, then you can't be out, or shouldn't be given out. Moeen bowls, and back in across again to a ball outside the off stump, a bit shorter that time, dropping the ball into the onside, picked up that short leg, and there is no run. Hope on 10. Four balls to survive until the lunch interval, and then a chance to reassess for West Indies. Moeen bowls, and that's spinning down the leg side and clipped away fine. And they're through for one. Throws on its way from the deep to Bairstow. Hope goes to 11. I think that's a nice feeling for a batsman in the last over before an interval, just to get a single and get to the other end. Now, because it doesn't guarantee anything that you won't face again, but I think I'm probably going to be there for the next session. Although Brathwaite's on 49. Might want a single. Moeen has a chat with Root, who's fielding at mid-off, just making him wait, just delaying him. He's got it looking around the field. Three men now in the deep for Brathwaite. So there's a man at cow corner. There's a long on, a deep backwards square leg. Although that's changing. He's sending his long on wider, so more towards cow corner. He's bringing the cow corner fielder in to mid-wicket.
I like this field.
And he's got a silly mid-on, a short mid-on as well, Anderson, close to the non-striking batsman. So Brathwaite on 49, three balls to go until lunch, and Brathwaite clips it to Jimmy Anderson. along on the banks at silly mid-on, and there is no run. Brathwaite has two balls to get his half-century before lunch. Moeen makes him wait again. As pauses before he moves into bowl to Brathwaite, who stretches forward, thickish inside edge, goes quickly on the ground to short leg.
Well, Shai Hope knows now, doesn't he? One ball to go before.
Unless he gets run out.
They never know, 49.
Yeah, well, that's it, yeah. Mm. If it was 99, it'd be a bit different, wouldn't it? But 49, you can wait. Moeen bowls to Brathwaite, last ball before lunch, and he's happy just to say, right, I don't worry about the 50. I'm more interested in making it through that first session, which has been another gripper. 86 for two. So from here, West Indies require a further 236 to win from 67 overs with 8 wickets in hand. England have got picked up a couple of wickets, probably the minimum they would have wanted from that morning session in decent bowling conditions. There was the drop catch of Brathwaite as well. He was dropped on 4 by Cook at slip. But this intriguing test match continues.
Yeah, I mean, he's such a key player for the West Indies, Brathwaite. 100 in the first innings. He's been joined by his partner from that double century partnership in the first innings as well. So two players out there with strong minds, strong confidence. Yeah, the drop catch of Alastair Cook. You just felt if Alastair Cook had taken that off Stuart Broad, with the way that Broad generally gets into one of those rhythms, doesn't he? And we've seen it so often in the past, and pick up 3 or 4 quick ones. That's a key moment. The West Indies are in this. Yeah, they'll be having a bit of lunch, saying, right, about another session, get till tea, get to within 150, and then you just never know. It's someone like Jermaine Blackwood and the likes of Jason Holder down that bottom end to come. I mean, it's a long shot. I still think England are quite clear favourites, but you just never, ever know.
Yeah, well, we thought in Dhaka, when Australia lost a couple of early wickets chasing 260, that they were out of that game, but they're right in it at the close of play. 109 for 2, chasing 260, with Warner 70-odd not out. It just feels it might... I mean, 2-3-6, 60. I mean, they've got enough time in terms of overs, but they'll have to bat with a great deal of skill.
Well, you just look back to yesterday, Simon, and Moeen Ali's innings. It feels that it's taken the game away from the West Indies. The pitch is playing OK, and a 250 chase and 225 or even just below that with the way that they had England 158 for 7. You know, I do think the West Indies have missed so many chances and so many opportunities to really pin back England this week. And, you know, you look at all this just iffy decisions or the bits of fortune, Stuart Broad getting one off the 5, running Kyle Hope at the non-strikers then. All those little things seems to have gone England way this week. Yet still, here on the fifth day, and the West Indies just have a sniff. Just feel if they can get Brathwaite, you know, I think they've got an end that they can really target. Shai Hope's in good form, but you know, Roston Chase hasn't got too many runs. Jermaine Blackwood, you know the way he's going to play, and you feel that he'll give you a chance or two. But Brathwaite bats the day. Can he be that first player to get 2 centuries in a match here?
What was your best here in 2 innings? Could you ever?
I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know? You don't remember anything? No. Okay, that's fine.
I got a few hundred, but I don't remember getting
close to one of the second innings.
No, I didn't get close.
So we're out today for West Indies. Kieran Powell was caught by Stokes at 4 slip off Broad for 23. That was 46 for 1. And then Kyle Hope was run out. Brathwaite hit one back. It was a technical chance. Broad didn't take it. And it deflected onto the stumps. And so Hope run out for 0, 53 for 2. But since then, Brathwaite and Shai Hope have batted securely. England today, or England's bowling figures, Anderson 9 overs, 4 maidens, no wicket for 18. Stuart Broad had a long spell this morning, bowled 8 overs, 10 overs, 1 maiden, 1 for 46, and that catch dropped. Moeen Ali, 7 overs, 1 maiden, no wicket for 14, and Chris Woakes, 3 overs, 1 maiden, no wicket for 5. So we haven't seen Ben Stokes in this second innings. So there we go. We're still going. 86 for 2 at lunch. West Indies, their target overall, 322, with 67 more overs remaining in the game.